30.
Yeah, sure. Can I welcome everyone to the seventh meeting in 2016 of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. Everyone present is reminded to turn off mobile phones as they affect the broadcasting system. As meeting papers are provided in digital format, you may see tablets being used during the meeting. We have received apologies from Siobhan McMahon. Agenda item one, subordinate legislation. The first item on the agenda is to take evidence on the Draft Procurement Scotland Regulations 2016. And I welcome Keith Brown, Cabinet Secretary for Infrastructure, Investment and Cities, Alistair Hamilton, Policy Manager, Scottish Procurement and Commercial Directorate, Susan Duncan, Policy Manager, Scottish Procurement and Commercial Directorate, and Mark Richard, Solicitor, all at the Scottish Government. This instrument is laid under affirmative procedure, which means the Parliament must approve it before the provisions can come into force. Following this evidence session, the committee will be invited at the next agenda item to consider a motion to approve the instrument. Alongside consideration of this instrument, the committee will also have an opportunity to hear from the Cabinet Secretary about the full package of subordinate legislation associated with procurement reform. Can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement introducing the instrument and other measures associated with public procurement reform?
Yeah, thank you very much, Convener, and thanks for the opportunity to discuss with the committee the changes being implemented. I know there are a substantial raft of changes to public procurement legislation in Scotland. Today, of course, is mainly to look at the Procurement Scotland regulations, although it's difficult to talk about that instrument without also touching on the other regulations that we've recently introduced. Those include the Public Contract Regulations 2015, on which the committee has recently written to me, the Utilities Contract Scotland Regulations 2016, and the Concession Contract Scotland Regulations 2016, and which transpose new EU procurement directives, as well as, just to add to that, the new statutory guidance provided for in the 2014 Procurement Reform Scotland Act 2014. Between February and April last year, we consulted on our plans on how best to transpose these directives and how to implement the provisions of the Act. And when I appeared before the committee last June, Convener, I stated that our intention was to ensure that changes would be as simple and as easy to follow as we could make them, and that we were also seeking to try to avoid, where possible, one set of rules applying to larger value contracts and a different set of rules applying to lower value contracts. I also said that respondents to our consultation seemed, for the most part, to have agreed with our proposed way forward. The regulations that we've now laid have therefore been drafted on that basis, very much following feedback from that consultation exercise. The responses have helped to shape the statutory guidance as well, which arises from the Reform Act. And throughout 2015, we also engaged with a wide range of stakeholders to help develop the content of that statutory guidance. I gave a commitment to fast-track the publication of statutory guidance that covered fair work practices and procurement, including the living wage, and that I published on the 6th of October, with the changes coming into effect on the 1st of November. I aim to publish the remainder of the suite of guidance by the end of February. The Procurement Scotland Regulations 2016, which you have been considering on your committee, implement the remaining provisions of the Procurement Reform Scotland Act 2014. And they should help ensure that procurement processes and procedures found in the public contract regulations and under the Act will be broadly similar, which allow for consistency and clarity. We did receive a number of requests to allow a reasonable period of time for the procurement community to make necessary changes to their internal processes and procedures. And for that reason, although I'm laying the regulations now, they will, for the most part, enter into force on the 18th of April, 2 years after they were required to do so, or 2 years being the period in which they have to be done. This is the same date on which the regulations transposing the EU directives will enter into force. And the gap between laying the regulations and them coming to force will allow time for changes and provide time to roll out training for purchasers on the changes to procurement rules. As part of the transitional arrangement, I've delayed the date that public bodies need comply with both the sustainable procurement duty and the community benefits obligation until the 1st of June. And that recognises that these will be normally be considered as part of a purchaser's procurement strategy and that strategies may be devised some months in advance of the procurement starting. And I've also delayed the date by which public bodies must publish their procurement strategies. Nobody will be required to produce a strategy before 31st of December this year. I know that the committee have some questions on the treatment of tax in these regulations, and I've seen comment to the effect that there is no reference to or substantial actions on tax dodging in these regulations, and that is categorically not the case. The Procurement Scotland Regulations 2016, the Public Contracts Scotland Regulations, Utility Contracts Scotland Regulations, and the Concessions Contracts Regulations all contain provision that can see businesses which have not paid their taxes excluded from the bidding process. For higher value contracts, it will be a legal obligation on public bodies to exclude a business where the non-payment has been established by a judicial or administrative decision. Public bodies can still go further and exclude a supplier where the non-payment has been established by other appropriate means, although the body in that instance will be able to reach a decision whether to exclude based upon all the relevant facts available to it. And it will not be the case that the Scottish Government nor the guidance can anticipate what all those facts will be in advance and in every case. And that provision is also the case for lower value contracts, that is, those ones governed by the Procurement Scotland regulations. So having said that, I'll not go into further detail at this stage, but there are other issues where we have carefully weighed up the arguments, such as on tackling blacklisting, reserving participation in competitions to mutuals, or reserving participation in competitions to supported businesses, as now defined in the new EU directives, and how to ensure that contract award criteria can take account of social considerations. And on those two last points, I've written to the committee, to the Commission, seeking clarification, and we still await a response from the Commission. So in conclusion, I welcome the opportunity to engage with the committee again, and I'm happy to try to address any questions or concerns that you may have.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, for that very helpful opening statement. The Scottish Government published its procurement policy note on the 18th of December of 2015, and as you've already alluded to, that the set of regulations seeks to transpose the EU Procurement Directive into Scots law. Given that Europe seems to be the dominant issue in the news at the moment, do you have any assessment of what the impact of what is commonly referred to as Brexit would be on this whole process of transposing EU procurement directives into Scots law would be?
I must say I didn't expect that question, but perhaps I should have done. It's perfectly topical and very relevant. I think the situation just now is obviously these directives and a huge number of other directives do bind us in what we do in public authorities in many respects. And if we suddenly didn't have to do that, you could maybe say on the one hand we have all this new freedom to do as you would wish to do without these constraints. But by and large, it's my view, these constraints are there for a good purpose. This ensures that we go through a fair and transparent process in relation to procurement. And we take in, as far as we're able to, other considerations in terms of social and socio-economic impacts, as well as making it a clean, as I say, and fair process. To suddenly not have that or not be bound by that, I think, would be a very difficult situation. And also, if you think about the amount of training that's required, the amount of investment that's made by public bodies and ensuring they comply with these regulations, it would, I think, undermine all that investment that's been made. So I think we benefit greatly from it. And of course, what it does is if we make sure that our provisions are fair and transparent, it allows us to properly engage our suppliers and contractors in Scotland to properly engage with other parts of the EU. I'm not sure they'd be so keen to allow us to do that if we weren't complying with the same kind of rules that they were. So I think it would introduce an element of uncertainty and perhaps make much less level the playing field on which purchasing currently takes place, and I would suggest we shouldn't do that.
Okay, that's very helpful, Cabinet Secretary. You said that there had been a period of about 2 years since the Procurement Reform Scotland Act had been passed, and the consultation exercise, and then the development of statutory guidance, and then the rollout of that in terms of dates for its implementation. I'm sure there are very good reasons why there's been that delay, but do you want to say a little bit more about why it's taken this length of time? And presumably, one of the issues you mentioned about training for purchasers and you know, getting this right is something we'd all be keen to see. But just if you could say a little bit more about that, it would be helpful.
Yeah, I think it does take... You could have taken the approach, for example, that the UK government have taken in relation to some of this, and basically what's called just copy out the regulations as they come from the Commission. We've taken a different approach where we've gone for substantial consultation. And as you say, there's also other considerations, allowing bodies to prepare themselves for this coming. So whether it's in relation to training, on the changes to legislation, that is a key area. And we've worked quite closely in partnership with stakeholders and to that end produced a comprehensive training package which covers all of the main changes. And it's also true to say the material which is produced as a result of that is available free to anybody to use. Regarding suppliers, our activity has been informed by the procurement supplier group, which has representative membership interests, and we're working on a range of measures, updating the advertising tools used by suppliers to bid for public contracts. The procurement journey, which is a web-based support tool, is also being updated. And we're also working in partnership with the Supplier Development Programme, a third-party organisation, in order to develop, going even further than the web-based materials and the other free materials, a series of roadshows planned for suppliers. So in addition to that, we've had face-to-face training sessions in Glasgow, Edinburgh, Aberdeen and Inverness, and hoping to have events in Shetland and Orkney. So I think that underlines why it is wise to take some time to do this, to try and make sure you bring stakeholders with you to have that consultation, and through training and providing as much advance notice as possible to make sure that both suppliers and public bodies are as ready as they can be. So I think that vindicates taking the time that we have done.
And what do you think the key advantages will be of the different areas of reform that are being introduced?
Well, there's a number of changes from what's happened before. It's probably a whole host, but I think it does help to... in one sense, there's more regulation there, which is building on previous regulation, but some of it makes things more transparent, easier to understand. I mentioned in the opening statement the attempts we've made to try and get consistency and clarity on these things, but right the way through, there are a number of different things which would apply. So, for example, the change in terms of supported businesses, making it a broader a definition in relation to that, is something which, if we treat it in the right way, I think is an advance on where we were before. And I mentioned also in my opening statement some of the ways in which we can arm public bodies to take decisions. For example, if a supplier has not been either paying tax or complying with environmental legislation or if it's been involved in blacklisting, I think these things mark progress from where we are before. So right the way through the different provisions, I think there are substantial new benefits, and that's not come out of the blue. The Commission, whatever they are sometimes accused of, do sit and ponder these things, and they also are approached both on the supplier side and also by public authorities. So I think what they've produced has been reflective of that, and we're just trying to see that through to make things a bit more clear and consistent.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to hand over to Mike McKenzie.
Thank you, Convener. I think, Cabinet Secretary, good morning. I think you've kind of anticipated the questions I had in mind to ask, but I wonder, you just touched briefly on the different approach the Scottish Government has taken compared to the rest of the UK and possibly also other parts of Europe. Could you just perhaps explain a wee bit more on that particular issue?
I think the most substantial difference, certainly between the Scottish Government and the UK Government, was this idea that we didn't simply go to copy out, as it's called, just replicate the regulations as they came to us. And we have taken the approach based on the Scottish model of procurement, and that seeks to balance out cost, quality and sustainability. I think I'm right in saying that down south you may very often be able to award contracts on the basis of price alone, whereas we've taken a different approach and made sure that quality is always part of that picture, although it varies the extent to which the balance is drawn. And it's why the Reform Act introduces a sustainable procurement duty and a requirement to consider community benefits in major contracts as well, something we've used for some time, but this takes it a stage further. Other member states, you've asked about them as well, they have national legislation on lower value procurement but have tended to simply extend the provisions in the EU directives. We've tried to introduce a more sensitive regime but with a stronger focus on sustainability, organisational strategies for higher spending bodies and performance reporting. And just one other example to try and help, the UK regulations or unlike the UK regulations, the regulations that we propose make it a requirement that any company which admits it has blacklisted workers or has been found to have breached blacklisting legislation will be barred from bidding for public contracts. So that's one example of where we're taking a different approach from, in this case, the UK.
I'm very glad in particular to hear you talk about community benefit as a consideration and quality as opposed to just price. I mean, I'm sure you'll know and that many of us experience frequent complaints from suppliers and contractors who feel excluded by the current procurement process. And it often strikes me that the companies that miss out on procurement and tend to be not those who are the worst suppliers or the best or the worst contractors, but sometimes those who are not best at procurement and how they actually engage with that. So I was very pleased to hear you talking about training and going out to areas as far afield as Orkney. Do you feel that it's a notoriously complex area? Do you feel there's perhaps a degree of simplification, or will the training allow smaller, more local suppliers and contractors the benefit of better understanding the procurement process and therefore not feeling as excluded as they do presently?
Well, I think first of all you have to see whether the procurement regulations, and there's a substantial body of regulations there now, are there for a good purpose, and I think that they are. And if that's the case, and you're quite right to say they can become quite complex, then it can present a bigger challenge for a smaller company than it will for a larger company. I understand that. I don't think that that means that we shouldn't have that body of procurement regulation which is there. So the only way you can remedy that is to give as much assistance as possible through training. I've mentioned face-to-face discussions as well. Also, I think you have to be proportionate. So depending on the contract that you have, you have to make the procurement environment, the context in which people bid, as proportionate to the size of the contract as possible as well. And we try and do that, this division between higher value contracts I mentioned and the lower value contracts. And you're right, the broader definition of sustainability has to be one which includes a healthy small and medium enterprise sector. I mean, for a long time under the old PFI regime, I was constantly being, as a local councillor, approached by bodies which felt, companies which felt they had no chance to compete for these large PFI contracts because of all the different legal and financial expertise that was required. So I think both through these regulations and also through things like the portal for applying for contracts, public contracts, I think we have tried to simplify that. I'm sure we're not at the end point of that, and it'll be a constant attempt to try and make it as easy as possible, as appropriate and as proportionate as possible to the contracts that we're doing. But by and large, I think it's right to have these regulations in place, and we should make it as easy as possible for people to comply with it.
Thank you. I just wonder, just finally, if you could share with the committee further details of the proposals for training and, you know, training meetings and so on, because I'm sure that would be of particular interest to suppliers across Scotland.
Well, I've mentioned what we've done and where we've done it. If you like, I'm happy to provide the committee in writing with more detail about all that training that we've been doing. And I think the Orkney Shetland ones are still not finalised, but perhaps as soon as we get that, I can share that with the committee in writing and let you know exactly what we've been doing.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Alex.
Inevitably, there will be cost implications in dealing with and conforming to the new regulations. Where that relates to public bodies and third sector organisations, will they just have to absorb these extra costs, or is there any way in which they can be provided with some support to overcome the transition and the ongoing costs?
Well, I think going back to the answer I've just given to Mike McKenzie, I think the training seeks to help to achieve that, to make it as easy as possible for contractors to do that. But the procurement legislation on which these regulations build have been in place for many years now. In fact, the first directive goes back to 1971, and it's now 10 years since we've had our own procurement legislation affecting, giving effect to the EU directives. The main instrument that we've introduced, which is the Public Contracts Scotland Regulations, is a replacement for the Public Contracts Scotland Regulations 2012, and also the 2016 ones replace ones from 2012 as well. So any cost implications for buyers and suppliers, who I think are the object of your question, under the new regime shouldn't be any different to what they've had before. That doesn't mean to say we shouldn't always try to concentrate on how we can minimise them. In terms of the impact under the Reform Act, the aim has been to embed the use of systems and policies that have already been put in place. We're not trying to just bring in new things and new requirements that require wholesale changes to what's currently there. A lot of this is building upon that. So I think that has been taken account. And going back to my previous point, I think, to be fair to them, the Commission also take that into account when they come up with these proposals. What we are seeking to do is to try and build that through to what we are doing. And also, again, going back to the previous point, the contract opportunities that we want to try and make sure are available to companies, we want to make sure they're transparent, readily accessible for SMEs as well and the third sector. And as I say, that means that procurement, taking it, the idea of sustainable procurement in its broadest sense, can be achieved if you do that. So you've got a healthy mix and real competition. So I think it is the case that there are costs attached to this. There's no doubt about that. It probably is also the case that we can continue to try and reduce the costs of that. I think companies themselves will do that as they become more aware and more expert over time. And we can help with that in terms of the training that we've offered.
Thank you.
Clear.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary.
Morning.
You mentioned time of being one of the themes that had come out in the consultation and the adaptations you've made to the introduction and timing of it, but were there any other themes to emerge during the government's consultation?
Yes, a number. I think some of which I would have mentioned at the previous meeting of the committee, but what surprised us is that the proposals that we made were, I think, in every case bar one, I think, very much supported by the consultees. Around 80, between 80 and 90%, sometimes 96% of consultees accorded. And so those were on things like allowing the maximum possible discretion for lower value contracts. That was something where I think that's probably the predominant theme that came out, which was these public bodies wanted to have the maximum amount of discretion. In some cases, in fact, in the vast majority of cases, we've agreed with that. In one case, I've mentioned blacklisting. We've gone further, perhaps, in consultees we'd want to have done. But I think that would probably be the predominant theme. I don't know if one of the officials, in fact, somebody's never been to a committee before, might want to say something about that, Susan Duncan. That'd be the main theme, but you want to say, if that's all right, convener?
Cheers, Cabinet Secretary. Yes, absolutely. Consistency and proportionality was very much the key theme. But from various sectors, local authorities, for example, were really keen that we didn't add any new bureaucracy or additional burdens on them, which is why, through our legislation or statutory guidance, it was important that we took that proportionate approach to allow them to make the decisions that were relevant for their particular organisation in their area. NHS bodies, interestingly, generally the theme there was about some more guidance on procedural rules. So again, that's where we've adapted our procurement journey as a tool to assist the buyers and also suppliers with regards to how the new rules apply in practice. And interesting, of course, third sector organisation and union representatives raised the issue of living wage, which of course we've been able to tackle quite significantly, really through our legislation and our statutory guidance.
Thank you. That was a very comprehensive answer. Thank you very much. Cabinet Secretary, you did mention blacklisting, and given that the convener opened the door in this issue earlier on, would you have any concerns about if there was a Brexit, as it's called, and given the travel of the UK government in terms of anti-trade union legislation, have you got concerns about what the impact would be for some of the protections you've been able to put in place if the UK were to leave Europe?
I suppose the main concern is that we know the situation and the way in which, I think, over recent years, European regulations have allowed us to increasingly focus on those things like blacklisting. And as Susan mentioned, in relation to the living wage as well, we can't quite go. I think the last time was at the committee, we discussed at some length the idea of the whether you can impose a living wage, and I think the conclusion, certainly mine, I think perhaps the committee's, was it's because we have the national minimum wage legislation in the UK that actually prevents us from imposing the living wage regulations. And the interesting thing is, if there was no national minimum wage, we could actually do that. But because there is a national minimum wage set too low in our view for a living wage, we can't do that. But I think that what you've seen over recent years is the EU trying to come to terms with those things. Now, some people will think they don't, they shouldn't be involved in that, and that's not right, and it's a constraint. We are very...
On that issue of the living wage, can we just be clear that the situation that you've outlined in terms of the restrictions that apply, that would be the case regardless of whether the minimum wage was devolved or reserved, is that right?
If there is, my understanding of the European legislation, if there is by a body, I think whether regional or national, as they would call it, which stipulates a minimum wage, then that does not allow you to separately set another constraint of a living wage, is my understanding of it. In fact, I think there's a recent ruling, a German ruling, which kind of points up that particular situation. Just to come back to the point, I think that we've moved towards this, and if there was to be a Brexit, then it's just a lack of certainty that that would continue. And I probably share your view that we don't have the same view on anti-trade union legislation that the UK government has, and if we were at the mercy of the UK government alone in relation to that, then I think that would be extremely worrying.
Thank you.
Okay, Alex.
We've heard about the consultation, but can you tell us a bit about how buyers and suppliers have reacted to the new rules as they've come forward? Basically, you know, are they content with what has come forward?
Well, as I said before, the consultation process allowed us to talk also to suppliers, and I've mentioned the different forums in which we had that engagement. Throughout that process, we've engage with them. It's included networked events, existing strategic forum meetings and individual meetings. They have made consistent references, I think as Susan was saying before, to the need for flexibility, to consistency and proportionality, and I think we can agree with them on that. I can see the logic. We have regular out with this process discussions with suppliers, and that's what they want to know. What's there is going to be there consistently. They want to know that what's been asked of them is proportionate to what they're undertaking, and I understand that, and also to have the maximum possible flexibility. But I think the training has also been very important, and we put in place measures to meet that demand for training. We're also in discussion with the supplier development programme to see what support we might be able to offer in respect of further training for suppliers. So I think we have been going with the grain of what suppliers have said. It's how we've approached the drafting of the regulations and the preparation of the statutory guidance. And there are bound to be things on which we disagree, but I think we have worked with the grain of what they've asked for in this case.
Thank you.
Adam.
Morning, Cabinet Secretary. I'm particularly interested in the area of supported businesses. You mentioned them in your opening remarks, and I recall when we were scrutinising the legislation 2 or 3 years back, there was quite a number of discussions about how best we can actually support supported businesses, and a lot of public bodies didn't actually go out of their way to do that. So I was interested to note that you had some resistance, can I say, to what you were proposing. Would you like to flesh that out a little bit for us, and why you think this is a step forward that you're taking in terms of support for supported businesses?
I think it's often the case that sometimes one person's opportunity is perceived as another person's threat. And I think that what's happened in relation to moving to, for example, this definition of a disadvantaged person, some people have seen the potential ambiguity in that as a potential threat. But to be honest, I think the bigger issue in my experience and out with even this process is really about awareness. I mean, obviously, some companies would not like a situation where a process is ring-fenced for only supported businesses. They would have a commercial interest in that, and they wouldn't like to see that. That's bound to happen, and we've seen some traffic in relation to that. They see it as a missed potential commercial opportunity for them. But much more than that, I think what has been my impression is that so many businesses, and it's true also sometimes in public authorities, are unaware of the opportunities that they can access through supported businesses. And also the supported business sector has got a job of work to do to make sure that what it's able to offer is much more widely known. So I think perhaps the biggest the biggest issue there was the perceived ambiguity of the move to 30%, having the need for 30% of the workforce made up of disabled or disadvantaged people. Disabled, I think even that can be an ambiguous term, but people had a broad understanding of that. Disadvantaged, I think, does provide some more ambiguity, and we sought to address that in the regulations. That's probably the main gripe, if there has been one, about supported businesses or disadvantaged groups.
And in terms of evaluating the impact of the legislation, will you be able to do that in terms of the number of contracts that are awarded to supported businesses and the like? Is that something that can be monitored as we go along?
Yes, we do that, and I think it then becomes a question of what you do if it's not having the desired effect. And I've got a feeling that will rest, as I've said, out with what regulations you can bring in, and much more to do with trying to proselytise with different organisations. But I don't know if you want to say something else about that, Susan?
Yeah, just to add to that, under the Scottish legislation, under the Procurement Reform Scotland Act, there's two areas there. There's the requirement for buying organisations to think about sustainable procurement duty, and part of that is how they can facilitate access to SMEs, third sector, but also supported businesses. So it's a genuine requirement. But there's also a requirement for them to report annually as a result of the procurement strategy commitments and how they have met those obligations. So that will provide an ideal opportunity for us to monitor compliance with that and whether we're increasing the use of supported businesses.
I think, incidentally, it's true to say that much of what we're proposing in the regulations are things which you'd want to have a look at in due course. So in relation to whether it's blacklisting or whether in relation to some of the other the tax avoidance issues, we do have opportunities to come back and revise this in light of experience, and we'll be looking to do that, so to monitor all the different aspects of it, including the one that you've mentioned.
Thank you.
David.
Thank you, Convener. You touched in your opening remarks, Cabinet Secretary, about tax avoidance, and you obviously had looked at the official record last time round when I raised that particular point. Could you give the committee an estimate of how much money is lost in Scotland every year because of tax avoidance?
No, I couldn't. We're not, in that sense, we don't collect corporation tax. We don't have that responsibility. I'm not aware of it. I don't know if any of the officials would have that information. No.
You'd be familiar, of course, with the excellent campaign being run by organisations like Christian Aid, SDUC, Unite Scotland. The figure they've come up with for the UK is £25 billion at loss per year. And a rough estimate, that would be around £2.5 billion in Scotland, obviously an immense sum of money. And particularly with the new tax powers, are the Scottish Government applying techniques to try and estimate tax avoidance? It's obviously very difficult to work out how much you're not getting, but clearly you can do some estimates. Is that something you can look at, particularly with large organisations which have a global reach, which perhaps do an excellent job in Scotland, like Amazon, but clearly there's been criticisms about tax avoidance that they're paying. Is this something the Scottish Government will look at in the future?
It would be the responsibility of John Swinney to look at that, not my responsibility. I agree with what Mr Stewart says, that these huge companies which seem to manage to determine their own tax rates offend the public perception. So I think it's a very serious issue, of course, that again will not be the responsibility of this Parliament anytime soon in terms of corporation tax. But I think what we've tried to do in terms, just to come back to the regulations for a second, is to give the opportunity for public bodies who are aware of certainly illegal activities to take action and preclude companies like that from competition if they are aware of that, if they have the evidence to suggest that. And I think that's an important step forward.
In the last 12 months, could the Cabinet Secretary identify how many companies were excluded from public procurement because of tax avoidance?
No, we don't keep records of every contract done by every public authority, so we wouldn't have that information. We provide the basis of the regulations and the environment, but we do not have the details of every public authority's contracts with different companies.
You will know the Scottish Government procurement companies, though. I mean, you're responsible for Scottish Government. How many Scottish Government contracts did you exclude companies because of tax avoidance?
Well, I would ask the officials if they've got any. I don't have any knowledge of that at all, but
I'm not aware that we routinely measure that information. We can certainly take it away and, right, and can get back to you.
A wild guess, would zero be close to the mark?
I wouldn't like to speculate.
Could you provide that material to the committee? If the information has not been kept, could suggest, Cabinet Secretary, that is kept, because clearly you can't monitor what you don't know, and it's obviously a huge issue. I mean,
can I ask if you're aware of any?
Well, I mean, as we've said, we're asking the questions. I think it's just important to identify. We have obviously some information on it. I would just through the campaign, but I would be really interested if you could identify if the Scottish Government excluded any companies because of tax avoidance, because you mentioned rightly at the start that you had a strong philosophical opposition to this, and I appreciate that comments. But in the end of the day, obviously, it's actions that count, and it's clearly very important that we try and look at this. I would certainly appreciate, Cabinet Secretary, if you could supply the committee with that information. My final point is really looking at further reforms to come in the public procurement regime. Can I raise just one issue that certainly Mr. Richard, I know, is interested in? When I went to Brussels last year in the Marine Division, they mentioned that the new procurement regulations, which obviously affect all European countries, but particularly what's happening here in Scotland, are what they would call TECL-friendly. And for those that have not come across that obscure regulation, it's basically the occasional opportunity where public bodies can avoid procurement for very good reasons, which I won't bore the committee or the witnesses with. So the officials made it quite clear to me that the new regulations were TECL-friendly. In other words, that it made it easier for not just Scottish Government, of course, local authorities as well, in the very rare, I appreciate, opportunities when TECL is apparent, that these procurement regulations help. Is the Cabinet Secretary aware of that? And if not, perhaps you could perhaps do a note back to the committee on whether the new regulations are more TECL-friendly than the previous regime.
Yes, you will do that note, and yes, we're aware of the extent to which it changes these regulations directly change that, although I don't think it does change it to a substantial extent. But just to come back to my previous point, and I'll do it by without making it a question, if that helps. I think any individual or public body that has information on tax avoiding companies really should pass that information on. I would hope that anybody, especially somebody making that point, that might have that information, would pass it to the government or the relevant public authorities so we can take that information on board. Happy to write to the committee on the points that were raised in the previous question and in relation to this question. I'm not aware of any contract, and obviously I don't have an encyclopedic knowledge of all the contracts where that would have a material effect just now, but obviously it's something you want to bear in mind in the future.
Question?
Yeah. That was all. Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, I mean, through you, Convener, I mean, I'm not actually expecting the Cabinet Secretary to have an encyclopedic knowledge. That's why I asked if you could write back to the committee. I'm merely making the point, if we're going back to the previous question, I don't doubt the Cabinet Secretary's principled stance on tax avoidance. I'm merely saying that what is needed then is action, and the first thing you need to do is have a system of recording that. I'm not expecting the Cabinet Secretary to know what local authority contracts have been rejected because of tax avoidance, but I would expect the Scottish Government to make a note of tax avoidance exclusions for its own contracts. I think that's a reasonable point, perhaps not one for the Cabinet Secretary, but one in the corporate way through other members of the Cabinet. So I think that's a fair and reasonable point. I mean, obviously I don't have inside information on contract awards. I'm merely making the point that we're obviously taking evidence from you, and I was merely asking that you responded to that. And I welcome your comments on the TECL exemption. My information came from the European Commission, but clearly you have a view on that as well.
Yeah, can I also just say there's a couple of contracts, more recent contracts, which have come up when the issue of tax avoidance, evasion, it's when a company would be doing something that's illegal, when that issue has been raised. I'll not name the contracts just now, but that issue has been raised, and we have investigated that and found there's no legal or illegal activity having taken place. So, but yes, of course it's important that we keep an eye on it. I would say we do take that into account, and we'll write back to the committee with any instances that we can dig up to confirm that too.
And my final point to the Cabinet Secretary is really from the campaign group that I mentioned earlier, who make the sort of understandable point that companies who wish to benefit from the public purse should pay their fair share of tax. Would you share the campaign's views?
Yeah, absolutely, but I would say if we're trying to come back to the reason I'm here today with these regulations, I think it's also true to say what the intention is, and I think what those campaign groups would also say is that the best result in those circumstances is to have the tax paid. And I think that underlies the approach that we've taken in relation to some of these provisions. If there's somebody that's transgressed, there's also an obligation you have under these regulations if somebody has what's called self-cleansed, actually take an action to mitigate or make reparations for what they have done or not, have not done previously, then that has to be, whether we like it or not, we have to take that into account. So obviously the intent has to be to make sure that everybody pays their fair share of tax, and I think these regulations help us to achieve that.
Yeah, and finally... Yeah, just finally, I think we share the same objective, that what we need is behaviour change by large companies who are clearly using their global reach to avoid paying tax in individual countries, which hits the public purse in Scotland, as it does England and the rest of the UK. And if we can get behaviour change, in other words, they pay their fair share of tax, then they've got their fair share of procurement contracts. If they're not paying the fair share of tax, they shouldn't be getting public contracts for the Scottish Government or local government, in my view, across Scotland.
And also, if everyone pays their fair share of tax, there are likely to be more contracts and more business for people.
Alex, you'd
I was just going to say that I'm not entirely convinced that either the questioner or the minister during the past 10 minutes has been truly honest about the distinction between tax avoidance and tax evasion. And I'm left extremely confused
Mr.
about
Johnson,
what we've been talking about.
Mr. Johnson, I don't think anybody in this committee is deliberately dishonest.
I'm not suggesting that's the case. I'm suggesting that perhaps there has been a misunderstanding over the last 10 minutes of what the difference between tax avoidance and tax evasion is. And therefore, I don't understand what we've been discussing.
Do you want to elaborate on that point?
Well, the fact that tax avoidance is an accounting practice, which is entirely legal, and tax evasion is an illegal activity which takes money out of the public purse that should not be and should be pursued through the courts. I think we have unhelpfully blurred the distinction quite blatantly over the last 10 minutes.
Would you like to comment on that, Cameron?
I could. Thanks, Convener. I don't think I have, and I tried to point out, perhaps not that explicitly, that there's a distinction between the two, and I mentioned both the terms there. I did, I think, try to point it out, though, by saying that where public authorities can take action on this is where there's been a finding by, you know, something that's a company that's contravened the law. And that does go exactly to that distinction. You will not be held up before the court, essentially, for tax avoidance. You can be held up before the court for tax evasion. So I did try to draw that distinction. I was not intending to be dishonest. And really, I have to answer the questions that are asked. I can't, as has been pointed out to me, ask my own questions. But I understand the distinction that's made there, and that is very much evident in the regulations. These authorities will not, by and large, be able to take action on such things which are not illegal. That's laid out in the regulations.
I think, just for clarity, Cabinet Secretary, I think the committee welcomes ministers and Cabinet Secretaries asking questions as part of a constructive dialogue, so we won't be too strict on that one. Adam, did you have a supplementary?
Yes, I'd like to commend the government, obviously, for introducing these procurement reform, particularly the desire to drive up standards from companies who are awarded public contracts. And you've obviously mentioned the issue of blacklisting of the living wage. I'm just wondering to what extent employment practices in general would come under the scrutiny, if you like, or for the awarding of public contracts, because we're all aware there are some employers who are better than others. We have a range of employment tribunal decisions, and we have other instances with regards to redundancy practices and this type of thing. Is that something that you have an intention of doing as part of this process, is to raise standards in companies of how they employ their people and the like? Is that something that is in your minds when you're introducing these regulations?
I think it is in our minds, and I think even before these regulations, it's been very prominent in our thinking. And we now have more discretion to capture those concerns as the procurement process goes forward. So I mentioned the living wage. It tends to be termed in a different way when you go through the procurement process. And I think it's probably fair to be clear and to be absolutely honest that procurement is not the best tool to deal with these things. Employment law is the best deal, and we have no powers in terms of employment law which is reserved. But there is a great deal that you can achieve. So, for example, the biggest contract that we let is the one for ScotRail services, around £8 billion worth, and we managed to achieve a great deal in relation to that in terms of redundancies, in terms of living wage, and living wage not just for directly employed people under that contract, but also for subcontractors as well. So you can achieve a great deal, much easier to achieve those things if you have control over employment law, though. I don't know, if, maybe I'm, in case I haven't mentioned somebody, is there somebody else worth mentioning?
Probably add to that. I mean, there's two areas where the new legislation, the supporting statutory guidance, assists with employment practice. By way of social, environmental and labour law, these are now exclusion grounds, so there's an expectation, naturally, that suppliers are complying with the law. But to go further than that, what we did through the statutory guidance published earlier that the Cabinet Secretary fast-tracked, this is statutory guidance on fair work practices, including living wage, and it is identifying how the way a supplier engages with their staff genuinely can have an impact on the quality of the goods, works or services that are actually being procured. So recognising there is a correlation between the two, and what that guidance does is go further and set out exactly how buying organisations can factor these issues in as part of the procurement process. And we're seeing that coming through now in some of the contracts being awarded, including the one the Cabinet Secretary refers to.
I think it's also true to say, to come back to this overarching approach of a sustainable procurement. Procurement's not sustainable if a contract's won on the basis of third world employment conditions. It's not going to work. So I think that probably generally, I couldn't point to a specific part of the procurement regulations that says that's what we will do. But the other points which have been mentioned allow us to say to somebody, and it's not true of all contracts, but the vast bulk, actually what you're proposing here, you know, if it's like terrible conditions for the staff, even if they're complying with the law, if the conditions are so bad that the contract itself doesn't seem to us to be viable, increasingly we're able to take that into account. But as I say, that's coming at it from, if you like, the side. The best way to deal with that, I think, is through employment law.
Thanks very much. Okay, thank you. Do members have any final questions for the Cabinet Secretary? Cabinet Secretary, do you have any final comments you'd like to make?
Thanks, Convener.
In that case, can I thank the Cabinet Secretary and his officials for their very helpful evidence this morning, and Cabinet Secretary, thank you for your commitment to furnish the committee with some further information. Agenda item 2, and the second agenda item is the formal consideration of motion S4M15451, calling for the committee to recommend approval of the Draft Procurement Scotland Regulations 2016. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak to and move motion S4M15451.
I'm just happy to move, Convener.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I invite any further comments and questions from members. There are none. In that case, the question is that motion S4M15451 in the name of Keith Brown be approved. Are we all agreed? In that case, that is agreed. That concludes the consideration of this affirmative instrument. We will report the outcome of our consideration to the Parliament, and I now suspend briefly for a witness handover.
we wouldn't have had them.
Just waiting for one of our members to return. Good morning, everyone. I now resume this meeting of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. As agenda item 3, the committee will take oral evidence on its inquiry into the circumstances surrounding the closure of the Fourth Road Bridge from the Minister for Transport and Islands. I welcome Derek Mackay, Minister for Transport and Islands at the Scottish Government, Roy Brannan, Chief Executive, Mike Baxter, Director for Finance and Analytical Services, and Wayne Hineshaw, Chief Bridge Engineer, all at Transport Scotland. Can I invite the Minister to make a short opening statement?
Thank you, Convener. Can I thank you for the opportunity to attend this important inquiry as I set out the Scottish Government's position on the matter. I welcome the inquiry as I have always encouraged transparency on this matter. I fully recognise the impact of the closure that it had on the travelling public, local and national business, and in particular those in the haulage industry who were inconvenienced, and I remain grateful for their patience and support. As indicated in my parliamentary statement on the 8th of December, I believe that the available evidence and expert opinion provided demonstrates that the truss end link defect could not have been foreseen. And I hope that we can agree that the decision to close the bridge was appropriate, reflecting the paramount importance of safety. And as bridge experts said and agreed too, that the subsequent response has been a remarkable achievement. Like other organisations with asset management responsibilities, FETA's use of a long-term programme allowed for certain projects to be prioritised for funding, reflecting the urgency of the work required and how it would impact on the integrity of the structure. FETA's system of general and principal inspections were developed to reflect the Fourth Road Bridge unique characteristics. Inspections were based on good industry practice with an enhanced methodology developed by FETA using a risk-based approach, meaning a more rigorous inspection regime which exceeded DFT guidelines. AMI has continued to use the same well-tested FETA procedures with the same experienced staff. The early identification of the defect was as a direct result of this competent regime. The familiarity of the staff had with the bridge and the structure, and a credit to those involved. Prior to its dissolution, FETA had full responsibility for all operation and maintenance aspects of the Fourth Road Bridge, including the prioritisation of its work programme. FETA's governance was such that the work programmes were approved by its board. When tolls were removed and FETA became reliant on Scottish Government funding, it was required to bid for funding through the spending review process, and it is clear that FETA had to adapt to new ways of working. Notwithstanding this, the Scottish Government ensured that funding was provided to meet FETA's committed spend and that capital maintenance was delivered on a prioritised needs basis. Funding for safety critical work was never refused by the Scottish Government, and FETA considered issues such as the truss end links to be manageable. FETA operated independently and employed its own hierarchy of risk. While the Bridgemasters Board papers were referred generally to truss end links, the associated works was not considered a significant risk nor accorded a safety critical or high priority. The inquiry has also heard about AMI's response. The strengths that the new operating company demonstrated are a direct outcome of Transport Scotland's thorough assessment of the contract procurement process and the skills and experience of AMI and its partners, which this committee has had sight of and has proved extremely efficient. The protections afforded to FETA staff and the ministerial commitment on staff pensions, both welcomed unanimously by the FETA board, management and staff and trade unions, played an important part in providing continuity of experience during the crucial mobilisation period, ensuring that all FETA staff in post in May 2015 transferred to AMI, including the bridge master. Since 2007, FETA undertook major works, including main cable investigation, cable band bolt replacement, anchorage investigation, viaduct bearing replacement, improvements to deck half joints, dehumidification system, and a number of other schemes. FETA deemed virtually all as more pressing than the postponed and unrelated full replacement of the truss end links. A total of £107.8 million has therefore been spent on the bridge in that period, equating to over £110 million, including reserves. That is not a record of underinvestment. In summary, I believe that the evidence presented to the committee, often from witnesses with quite different perspectives, has demonstrated that the structure has been well maintained, using good industry practice, that the defect which resulted in the bridge closure was unforeseen and unforeseeable, and that Minister's approval of AMI's proposal to close the bridge for a short period of time to carry out essential repairs was both appropriate and necessary. Now, members will be aware that the bridge is now fully operational, and I would again like to pay tribute to all the staff involved for the swift and dedicated actions undertaken in often very challenging circumstances. And I now welcome any questions from the committee.
Thank you very much, Minister. I'm going to hand over to David Stewart to kick off our questions today.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. And I'm sure on behalf of the committee, we'd like to echo the words you've made about all the work of the staff. As you know, a number of the committee members went to the bridge and we met some of the staff involved, so perhaps you could relay our comments to all the staff involved. Can I talk to you from the first few questions about decision making around the closure of the bridge? As you will be aware, most of the closures out with the current emergency are because of high winds. Could you identify what the decision making around the bridge closure is? In other words, who makes the decision, what the chain of command is as far as that's concerned in the current regime?
In terms of separate to this individual closure, but more generally on weather warnings. So based on forecasts and the information available, and the member, David, will be very well aware, and so should be very well aware, that there's specific monitoring equipment to more exposed structures in Scotland, such as bridges. That then informs, for example, whether particularly high winds, and if it hits levels that are predetermined, that then leads to warnings and a hierarchy of closure and restrictions to different types of vehicles crossing the bridge. That's conveyed to the public through variable message signs, as well as Twitter and Traffic Scotland and other broadcast media. Processes in place. It's almost automated now because of the criteria that's set, and ultimately decisions in terms of who actually makes the decision comes from, via the local information through Transport Scotland now, but the data from the bridge itself on the high winds that have been experienced on the structure, as well as the wider weather warnings.
Yeah, so thanks for that. She's fast. I suppose what I'm trying to identify is the specific individuals. I mean, is it the bridge master? Is it the head of Transport Scotland? Is it yourself as minister? Is it the cabinet secretary? Is it the first minister? Who is ultimately responsible for a closure in a high wind scenario?
I can answer that.
If I could just add to what the minister said, it's ultimately it's the organisation that's responsible for the bridge. So in the case of our other long span bridges across the country, it's the operating company. In the case of Forth Bridge, before the dissolution of FETA, it would have been FETA and Barry. After the 1st of June, it was AMI. So well-documented procedures that FETA had previously followed through into the new operating company contract, the Forth Bridge contract, and it's AMI that trigger those thresholds based on the weather forecast.
So if it was, for example, for high wind 70 miles an hour beyond, the head official in AMI on the bridge would be the responsible person who would make the decision to closure.
Correct.
And obviously copying the minister and...
Well, there's a whole procedure in place of things that they need to do when that threshold is reached. So that individual then makes a number of calls to ourselves, to Wayne as the Chief Bridge Engineer, and we're, everybody's aware at that point of what's happening. But the key important part of all of it is communicating to the public.
Chair, appreciate that. That's helpful and clear. Could perhaps just go back in history to clarify perhaps assumptions I have, which may be correct or may be incorrect. If we look at... there's really two periods of FETA, wasn't there? There was FETA when they had tolls and FETA after tolls in terms of decision-making. Am I right in thinking, Minister, that decisions to close the bridge when FETA was responsible during the tolling regime would have been the bridge master effectively alone would have had the power to close the bridge?
The bridge master would have made the decision, yes.
Yeah. But there was... So that was my understanding, but I just wanted to clarify that. Post-tolls, obviously, there was a change, and as you know, we've had evidence from FETA about this. In your scenario of high winds or whatever, who was then responsible? Was it still FETA, or sorry, was it still the Bridgemaster in FETA, in conjunction with Transport Scotland, or was it FETA Bridgemaster alone?
Still the Bridgemaster.
If I could add to that, it would have been the Bridgemaster alone. It was FETA's responsibility up until the day they were dissolved. They would have made that decision, but they worked closely with Traffic Scotland and Transport Scotland.
Yeah.
There was a sort of a seamless interface to ensure that that information was publicised and passed out. I mean, there's 5 wind thresholds. If the committee wants to know about them, they can. But effectively, the bridge is closed to all vehicles at 80 miles an hour. And if the bridge is closed, which is what you're talking about, that information is shared with Transport Scotland. Our permission was not sought, nor was it necessary to seek our permission. But we were informed so that we could put the standard incident diversion routes into plan and publicise that.
Yeah, and just perhaps you...
Sorry, can I just add one?
Certainly.
It's really important that... As part of that process of transfer, the Barry and the team and the board were particularly concerned about operational and maintenance issues moving away from themselves to Transport Scotland and indeed the corporate governance. They sought assurance from the Minister at the time and they got that. So operational and maintenance issues and corporate governance remain with Barry and the Chief Bridge Engineer.
And could you just clarify as well, Minister, if I got this correct? There was a period where there was a change and the bridge was designated a trunk road. Am I correct in that assumption during the transfer between FETA, or was it always designated trunk road in terms of transport regulations?
If I may add, the bridge was trunked when FETA were dissolved on that day.
Yes.
It was not a trunk road before that.
Yes.
And it remained, should we say, under the FETA Act. They were the roads authority under the Roads Scotland Act. And once it was trunked on 1 minute past midnight on the 1st of June, it then became the responsibility of the Scottish Government.
Uh-huh. Right. So my assumption was right then. There was a trunk road designation effectively on the 1st of June last year. Is that
correct? Is correct.
Thank you. That's useful to get these practical points confirmed. Can I move to just the current situation of the closure and the, again, I'm talking, Minister, about decision-making. If I could just run through this, and I don't know the answer to this question. The decision to close one carriageway of the Fourth Bridge was made on the 1st of December. Now, that followed discussion between AMI and Transport Scotland. The decision to close the bridge to all traffic from midnight on the 3rd of December followed a recommendation by AMI at 4 p.m. that day. Just confirm if that's...
No. Well, the exact timeline, you were right to begin with. In terms of a fault being identified on the 1st of December, that led to some restrictions, as you've described, on the closure of carriageway. There was further inspection, further study of the issue and engagement of consultants as well, monitoring of the Field Link member, leading to the 3rd of December, those ongoing meetings. Transport Scotland and AMI were obviously closely engaged. And the point of decision is the only inaccuracy I think you've given, Mr. Stewart. But that's where we come to a meeting of ministers in the evening of the 3rd of December, which was around 8 o'clock, half past 8, it was about half past 8, I think, which involved the First Minister, Deputy First Minister, Cabinet Secretary and myself, information presented, recommendation presented at that point to ministers, recommendation to ministers for the first time, within minutes of ministerial agreement that the bridge should be closed That was then conveyed to the media. So it's not the case that a decision was taken earlier in the afternoon, conveyed later. It was within minutes in the evening.
I think perhaps it was because I didn't quite finish my sentence, but I'm not necessarily disagreeing with you, Minister, about what the point I was going to make, but did not take effect until after a meeting with the First Minister. And what I was getting at, in line with my previous questions, and I appreciate this was an emergency situation, not a standard high wind closure, but in the case of the closure on the 3rd, was effectively the decision taken by the First Minister, the Cabinet Secretary, yourself, or by Amy? In that scenario, where did the backstop?
Well, recommendation came from officials and the operating company, Amy, to ministers, and we were all agreed. It was unanimous across the operating company, Transport Scotland, advisers and ministers to close the bridge and then embark on the next course of action. I'm sure you'll appreciate, and we may go on to this, we realised that this wasn't just a question of closing the bridge and that's it. There was much more to be done around contingencies, conveying the message to the public, and then repairing the bridge and getting a full understanding of what had happened. So, yes.
Thank you. Can I just move on? You kindly invited the committee and officials to attend a technical brief, which the convener, myself and Mr. Johnston and our officials attend. And I would say, again, that was very helpful and very useful. And I think in response to a question from my colleague, Mr. Johnston, the question was, as you recall, when the bridge reopens, will it be restricted or unrestricted? And the answer, Mr. Johnston can clarify, I think, was that when it reopens, it will be unrestricted. Can you just explain why it was going to be unrestricted in December and then was restricted when it opened? Why was there a confidence to us in December that then wasn't there in January?
So as the repairs have been undertaken and there's been further investigation and a deeper understanding of essentially what went wrong on the bridge, with those further inspections and monitoring equipment on the bridge, monitoring equipment that wasn't there before, like the strain gauges and the tilt meters, which then inform our understanding of the bridge. With all that in place, with that deeper understanding, you can make even better informed decisions around what went wrong, how you remedy it, and what you do going forward. Of course, for purpose of clarity, the bridge is now fully operational as it was before the closure, and there are no such restrictions. But during that period where we returned general traffic over the bridge, other than HGVs, that was over 90% of traffic on the 23rd of December, about 90-91%. The reason HGVs essentially couldn't go over, although they're only about 9% of the traffic, they're about 30% or so of the weight load. When the repairs were being carried out, there was further monitoring, further examination, deeper understanding because of the monitoring equipment. And it suggested, and this is something that I was able to outline at a further technical briefing, that as we all now know, the issue relates to a pin that wasn't rotating that put stress on the member. And we had inspected the other pins to find that two other pins were not rotating as we would like. That could put pressure and stress on those members. Therefore, it was good precaution to complete all the repairs to satisfactorily allow HGVs over the bridge. So it was an incremental return. The pressure was certainly on to get all traffic over as quickly as possible, whilst never compromising on safety. But as we learned more about the fault, the nature of the fault, the stress and pressures on the bridge, the fact that two further pins hadn't been rotating, we took that precautionary approach as to not cause any further damage to the bridge and safely allow traffic to cross and then HGVs to return in good time. So it was all a well-informed approach, precautionary, completing the repairs, strengthening the bridge to the point that we were satisfied that no further damage would be caused. And we could go into even more detail on our understanding of that based on the strain gauge and the acceptable parameters and the load testing and the model case scenarios. I'm happy to go into, and I'm sure Wayne will very enthusiastically join me in going into the detail of this, but that essentially is the answer. We understood more about what required to be done as we applied more technology to the bridge, had a deeper understanding of the nature, which was unforeseen, of the fault, and therefore what was the right thing to do to go forward to protect the structural integrity of the bridge.
So the bridge obviously is fully open to HGVs, and I think my memory serves me right, the maximum weight's around 44 tonnes, isn't it, of an HGV. When we were given the technical brief, we were told there's occasions where abnormal loads, such as perhaps a turbine that's been moved, might be up to 150 tonnes. Has there been any discussions with your technical officials whether there might be some restrictions to abnormal loads? In other words, loads that are above the weight limit for HGVs.
Mr. Stewart raises a valid point. I think there was one example of such an abnormal load in the last few years crossing the bridge, and potentially still could be by arrangement, but it would be by arrangement. That was the case before the bridge closure and could be the case after. Wayne?
If I could add that to the Minister, yes. In February 2015, the bridge master introduced a weight limit on abnormal loads of 150 tonnes. He would not permit vehicles over 150 tonnes over it, and that was because of concerns they had about the strength of the brackets and the welds in the towers that support part of the truss end link mechanism. That's the works that FETA trialled and that AMI have completed. We are back in a situation now with the bridge as we were before the 1st of December. Abnormal loads up to 150 tonnes can apply to be moved and can be moved across the Forth Road Bridge. These aren't an issue. Abnormal loads, though, periodically do go well beyond that into the several hundreds of tonnes, and it is those types of loads. Now, it isn't that the bridge may not be able to take them, but they may have to be specifically analysed for, and then traffic arrangements put in place whereby they are led across the bridge under what we would call caution, whereby there is no other traffic on the bridge, winds would need to be low, moderate temperatures. But to put you in mind of the usage by such loads on the Forth Road Bridge, they do not tend to follow the Forth Valley Passage. They tend to go via Stirling. And the last load, heaviest load we had, was 140 tonne in 2013. So the impact on the heavy haulage industry is very limited. But like all loads, the heavy haulage industry can apply to move loads, and if necessary, the bridge can be analysed to check if it can accommodate them.
So can we just be clear, is the limit still 150
tonne? It is 150 tonne at the moment.
Okay.
And are you satisfied, Mr. Stewart, with the answer on why the difference between opening to other traffic, and that over 90% of traffic at the end of December, and why there was that further period where we couldn't allow HGVs over? Are you satisfied
with
that?
I think it was useful to get the clarification, because you do accept we were there when we were told there wasn't going to be a restriction, and then suddenly we realised there was.
Expand further then and put it a different way? The assumption, well-informed, was that there was the crack, as you know, related to the pin that wasn't rotating in one part of the structure. When we identified that two further pins weren't rotating, we wanted to ensure that same precautionary works were carried out there so that we had satisfaction that it wouldn't put any further stress on the bridge, and that's the difference here. We concluded all those works, we strengthened the bridge so that we were satisfied that it wouldn't overstress any of the elements, all of which was informed by the new technology on the bridge. Is that more helpful?
Thank you for that. And so one final thing, just on the weight issue. There isn't any restrictions to HGVs, which obviously we welcome, and obviously we've had representations, I'm sure, from the haulage industry. Is there any restrictions on numbers of HGVs going over at one time? Because the engineers have explained to us that that causes difficulties.
No restrictions of that nature. There was, during that temporary pilot period where I was phasing the reintroduction of HGVs to the bridge for the reason that I've given around acceptable parameters of stress levels on the bridge until the works were complete, but there's now no such restriction and no requirement for any such restriction.
Okay, thank you. If I can just move on, Convener. Could you perhaps clarify, Minister, exactly where the Phase 1 repairs, the splint repairs, have been installed?
The Phase 1 splint repairs were started off, of course, on the broken member, then carried out on the others. The splint, as you'll recall from the technical briefing, was to essentially strengthen it to kind of shoe in the crack and give it that strengthening. So first of all, northeast tower, and then carried out on the other towers.
Then clarify the phase two installation. Was that on four locations?
On a number of locations, it's the four main span areas in phase two to begin with, and then a further four.
Okay, so Phase two was on four locations, and that's obviously all been completed.
So the four internal parts of the tower, so the suspended span section, that's what's been done as phase two today, and then the four external need to be completed as well. So, but they're not critical for traffic running on the bridge.
And just on the technical point, Minister, it's perhaps one through Mr. Brannan and yourself. We've been told, is it accurate to say that the pin on the north west corner of the main span is operating correctly?
It's probably one for Wayne to answer, but it's showing through the strain gauges, it's showing no signs of stress that the other pins were showing. So, yes, it's operating sufficiently to allow no further work required on that particular element.
Okay, thank you, Convener. That's all my questions.
Thank you. Minister, we're very keen, obviously, to get as much factual information on the record to assist with our inquiry, which I think is the reason why David Stewart has taken a bit of time to try and establish some of that. There's a few other additional points I'd like to get on the record, if I may, perhaps from officials rather than from yourself. But can you provide the committee with information on the additional problems with seized pins that were found and announced on the 5th of February, and which further delayed the opening to heavy goods vehicles beyond mid-February? When they were found, where they were located, and what repairs to them have been carried out?
Okay, and can I just preface that with the good news is, having identified that and undertaken the works, they're now not the issue that they were at that point, because we were undertaking the works anyway. So I wouldn't want the impression that it's an ongoing problem, because the repairs that have been undertaken has addressed that to the point that we can satisfactorily allow vehicles back across the bridge. But Wayne?
Yeah, if I can add to that, we started before Christmas installing structural monitoring equipment, data acquisition units, fibre optic cabling and electrical feeds, and that was all in place at the northeast truss end link before load testing took place, and that informed us on the stresses and strains that were going on. We then decided that we would install that at the other locations, particularly in the main span, where we considered that because we had one seized pin, there was a possibility that we could have problems elsewhere. At that time, we had done a further analysis, which had proven that whether the pins were seized or not seized, this wasn't an issue for the side spans, that the splint-strengthened members could take the induced bending stress and technically could live with that, although that was not how they were originally designed to behave. As a result of this, a lot of pressure was put on to put the data analysis, the box computers in the towers at the southeast tower and the southwest. We were able to rig the data acquisition unit in the northeast tower to monitor what was happening at the link at the northwest, and this showed from strain gauges and from movement graphs that that pin was rotating and not generating the stress in that link. To answer the specific question, convener, it would be early January, the second weekend in, when we got the data acquisition unit in the southeast tower, which we, in layman's language, jury-rigged to measure the southwest as well, before we got that acquisition unit from Germany, that gave us the information that sadly we would rather have not had, that both the pins on the main span at the southwest and southeast link were displaying high levels of friction, if not higher levels of friction, than that had been displaced at the northeast pin. And so at that time, we realised that we were going to have to implement the phase two repairs to those links.
Okay, that's very helpful. So the bridge reopened fully to HGVs on the 20th of February, and that is earlier than the anticipated date of mid-March, which had previously been advised and which was announced on the 5th of February. So what were the factors which allowed for an earlier opening?
Well, convener, although there was severe weather impacts, there was one successive storm after another. And in any event, weather impacts led to restrictions to other bridges, incidentally. But so there was the weather impacted on the repairs programme, on the works, because you cannot have staff working on the bridge in dangerous conditions. So when it was particularly windy, staff may have to come off the bridge in a safe fashion. But this was a 24/7 operation. You know, staff teams were programmed to be on the bridge as much as possible, to be carrying out the work in quite challenging circumstances. So a 24/7 operation to get the bridge repaired, and that was accelerated as much as possible. As it happens, after setting the new timescale, the weather improved. I set out that there was time for contingency. I said it publicly at the press conference and in the release that there was time for contingency built in. We wouldn't want to identify any new faults, but the weather impacted very positively then, following the amended date to mid-March. So there was better weather, more favourable weather. But the other issues, as I say, the 24/7 working, the real dedication to get the job done as quickly as possible with confidence. But different ways of working as well. So Amy was putting pressure on their suppliers to get, you know, supplies as quickly as possible. There was work carried out in the workshops rather than on site at the bridge, for example, that accelerated the programme, and the programme was reordered with some of that in mind to just accelerate everything. And we were all pleasantly surprised that it would come in ahead of the publicly stated timescale of mid-March. But those, I suppose, are the three key elements: that dedication of 24/7 working. You know, we didn't down tools, staff, they didn't down tools other than for the weather. The weather was more favourable, and with pressure on suppliers, work going on in workshops, that degree of re-engineering, as it's been described, allowed far more effective execution of the repair.
Helpful, thank you. Can I move on and ask you about the costs of permanently repairing the bridge? When Transport Scotland officials appeared before this committee on the 20th of January, they offered to provide additional information on the cost of the Forth Road Bridge's structural monitoring system, the cost of the next phase, phase two of repairs, and the cost to replace all linkages. Now, we've received that information, and it comes with a figure for repairing, permanently repairing the bridge of around £19.7 million. Can I give you the opportunity just to place on the record the various phases of the proposed repair work and the associated costs for each of these?
I'm happy to do that, Convener, but can I once again caveat that with not all the costs are settled, and you know there may be other variables here, but I can certainly give you what I have at the moment, and that figure remains the same, but I'll detail it as you've requested. So my understanding is that for the Phase 1 splint repairs, the cost is up to £3 million. The Phase 2 repairs, the cost is £2.65 million for the four that I've mentioned, with a further four, as Mr Stewart has asked about, so that further four is a further £2.65 million. For the Phase 3 works, which is still to be worked up and fully designed for then implementation, more detail. So the four main spans is £5.7 million. And with the side spans work being in a similar order of 5.7. So that's right, that does take you, Convener, to the £19.7 million. And the strain gauge, is the structural health monitoring system, is in the region of £1 to £1.5 million. So those are the figures that I think we've shared, but I have to attach that caveat that they are not settled figures.
Thank you. That anticipates my next question, of course, which is, do you consider... Well, clearly you don't consider this to be the final definitive cost of the repair work. It could be less, it could be more in the future.
I'm hoping, Convener, that it's in that region, but yes, that's right, that's not settled.
Okay. Thank you. I think we'll leave it at that. I'm going to pass over to Claire Adamson.
Thank you very much, Convener. Minister, as part of the spending review in 2011, how did Transport Scotland assess the indicative capital plan prepared by FETA and determine the level of capital grant that was to be provided for the years 2012-13 to 2014-15?
Well, this would have been a two-way process between FETA and Transport Scotland in view of the UK spending review, which had a very significant impact on the Scottish Government's budget. So there would have been an exchange, but I can assure you that what would have been expressed to FETA at the time is that there should be a degree of prioritisation, that committed projects would be seen through in terms of what was committed. Anything that was critical in terms of the health of the bridge would have been funded, and the reprioritisation that FETA would have undertaken would have been in the light that Scottish Government through Transport Scotland would expect a tiered approach, beginning with actions that don't diminish the structural integrity of the bridge. So it's a tiered approach of what's necessary to maintain the structural integrity of the bridge, its ongoing maintenance and operation, and therefore it would be taken in that light. Yes, there were financial pressures that everyone in public life faced, but the ongoing careful management of the bridge would have been expected, and there would have been that ongoing dialogue between Transport Scotland and FETA. But I've seen the evidence that you've also seen, which is, I think, that all appreciate that if any critical repairs had been identified, they would have been funded.
Thank you for the answer, Minister. There was some evidence that said that the revenue from the tolls had been critical to the capital programme for the bridge. But in the years that the tolls were in operation, FETA had accumulated quite high reserves in those years. At one point, the reserves sitting at £18.6 million. Can you give us an indication of what you think about those levels of reserves, and how close are they to the budgets for bridges in Scotland?
Well, what I can say is, if I can relate this back to the question of the capital plan, many members are aware of local government and other public sectors. Capital plans list a number of things. They're not always completed in 1 year. It might be a long-term capital plan, and they might relate to other things. Again, it's not the perception that the capital plan in relation to the Forth Road Bridge through FETA was all about the structural maintenance of the bridge or critical repairs. I could reference £1.4 million plan for tower painting, or landscaping works at £40,000, or vehicle replacement at £70,000. So I'm giving some of the nature of the capital plan around that. And their capital plan appears to have been taken in isolation, separate to initially the indicative capital plan from the spending review process and the resources available. So I suppose to answer your question, that even with their own indicative capital plan, and this is without criticism, you're right on the toll income, that I'm looking at the toll income, which for FETA was £11.99 million in 2006-07, or £10.299 million in 7-8, or £10.1 million in 2008-09. So there's an example of the toll income, which would have served both revenue and capital at the time, and there were substantial surpluses or monies held in reserve. Yeah, and I'm not here to criticise spending decisions of FETA, but to put into context, FETA replaced the toll collection equipment in 2005-06 at a cost of £8.5 million. On the abolition of tolls in 2008, it cost £2 million to remodel the plaza area to allow free-flowing traffic. So that kind of helps inform your understanding of the capital plan. So when we move from the tolls into government grant, I've given you figures ranging from £12 million across to £10 million. That was the toll income. In terms of then moving into government grant, for example, in 12-13, it was £11.38 million. So that's £5.1 million in revenue and £6.28 million in capital. And yes, there was the use of FETA reserves as well. So I would challenge any suggestion that the bridge was underfunded.
Thank you, Minister, for clarification there. Obviously, the decisions that were taken, the indicative capital plan has been in place for a number of years, with the truss end link replacement being part of that. But what difference did the decision to build the Forth Crossing have on the decisions about asking for a relook at that capital plan going forward?
I think my understanding from FETA is that FETA themselves considered the prospect of the fourth replacement crossing coming and would clearly reorder and reprofile works as a result. What what's required earlier on and what's required could be deferred until later in view of potential disruption, because that's always an issue when it comes to bridge maintenance and potential bridge closures, available resources, and yes, what can take place once the new, as it is called, the Queensferry Crossing is built. So I think FETA understood that and reordered some of their own works. Incidentally, the reprioritisation of FETA's capital programme was a matter for that independent organisation. The dialogue between Scottish Government through Transport Scotland and FETA was around finance, with a clear understanding that FETA should do nothing that undermines the structural integrity of the bridge and approach the government if there was a requirement for any critical repairs. And incidentally, they did. And I'll give you one example. In 2012, a request for more resources for cable band bolts, and that was accepted by Transport Scotland, and I think around £2 million paid out. So I've heard suggestion that some elements of FETA were frightened to ask the Scottish Government for money, because the answer would have been no. That's not normal in Scottish public life, I have to say. Folk are not normally frightened to ask for more resources if it's required. But in this instance, there is a clear example of identified works of a more critical nature brought to Scottish Government and delivered with agreement. And it wasn't, it wasn't already in the Scottish Government's programme. So there's a £2 million of example. If asked and the case was made, it was granted. And I think the committee should be aware of that, because it does contradict some of the unsubstantiated evidence you were presented with earlier.
Thank you, Minister.
Can I just add two things to what the Minister said? One is in relation to Board Paper 20th of February 2009, and in that it makes reference to the fact that the announcement of a firm commitment by the Scottish Government to a definitive programme for the construction of the fourth replacement crossing has allowed for a review of the authority's maintenance programme to be carried out. And one of the schemes that was reviewed at that time was the main expansion joints on the bridge itself. Barry and the team had taken forward a very innovative and creative scheme to replace those joints, which would have required temporary ramps to take traffic up above the bridge deck and then down again to allow traffic to continue to use the bridge. But those temporary ramps were valued at £6 million. So when certainty came around with the new bridge coming along, Barry looked at that again, put in another innovative and creative scheme to manage those joints, and that's what's in place today. So a saving to the public purse by looking very closely at what could be deferred on the basis that the new replacement crossing would be programmed and guaranteed.
Can I ask Minister, what's the value of the replacement crossing project?
The value in terms of cost and estimated costs, it's eye-watering, but well worthwhile, of 1.4.
The current range that we have is 1.325 to 1.35 billion in total.
Considering the investment in the infrastructure, I would say.
Well, I think some people have asked me, what's the contingency in the future to the Fourth Road Bridge? Now, if well maintained, the Fourth Road Bridge can, continue to our satisfaction, but I think we'll have a rather substantial contingency right next door to the Fourth Road Bridge, the Queensferry Crossing. So they both act as a contingency for each other, and it gives us more flexibility and options for the future for any works required on either bridge.
Thank the Minister. I would like to say on record as well, though, convener, that from all the evidence from the experts, it's been an astounding achievement to get the bridge back up and running in the timescales, and it's to be commended.
Thank you. I think you speak on behalf of the whole committee when you say that. Minister, we received, obviously, expert evidence from a range of witnesses, including the former Chief Bridge Master, Barry Colford. He said in evidence to the committee on the 27th of January, and I quote, "As I said, FETA was in a position whereby we had the governance but not the funding." He went on to say, "We prepared the capital programme, the board approved the capital programme or plan, and then we had to ensure that we got the money for that capital programme or plan. That involved negotiation and discussion with Transport Scotland." You've given us a little bit of an insight into that process of negotiation and discussion. But is there anything else you'd want to say?
Yes, I'd simply want to go on and complete his evidence there. He also pointed out that he enjoyed a good relationship with Scottish Government through Transport Scotland. And that was a mature relationship where issues would have been identified and there would have been a dialogue with technical understanding and a financial understanding to address any issues that would needed to have been addressed. And I gave you one example of even after the financial agreement having been reached, that further funds were allowed for cable band boats in 2012. So I think the relationship was very important and the process was important. And even if FETA had continued, they would have been relying on the toll income, which I've given you the examples of Scottish Government grant income, the use of surpluses, as well as was funded when it was provided through the toll. So even in the days of FETA, pre-toll abolition, then they could only have spent what they could raise. So I simply make the point, it was never the case that capital plans could always be delivered immediately in full. So it was a matter of financial availability. And with the dialogue and relationship that was enjoyed between FETA and Scottish Government, ensured a mature relationship, and prioritisation was a matter for FETA, independent of Scottish Government, but certainly anything that had been critical would have been funded, and there was strong awareness of that.
Thank you, Minister. You've said already that capital spending was on a needs prioritised basis, and you've just repeated again your view that if there were any critical repairs, they would have been funded. But surely the point about prioritisation of projects is that that prioritisation by FETA only happened after the budget had been confirmed in 2011.
The indicative programme would have covered a number of matters, and I gave you some other examples of painting and other aspects of an indicative capital programme. Within that, the FETA would have prioritised their works on the advice of their experts and the Bridge Master, and there is the understanding that if all actions would have been undertaken in a way that doesn't affect negatively the structural integrity of the bridge. The expectation from government post-spending review, or spending review beyond, was that there's a tiered approach, so work up the capital programme based on what is actually required to protect and maintain the structural integrity of the bridge. And there are some elements, other elements of, you know, what would be nice to do, what would be good additions, and they clearly weren't a priority. And incidentally, since we're talking about it...
My point is that reprioritisation of projects within the capital programme only happened after the budget had been confirmed in 2011. That is the case.
That is the case, yes, that their prioritisation was in light of the spending review. So indicative capital plan and then financial dialogue and then leading to what will they be able to proceed with. So that was a matter for FETA to prioritise, that's right.
Okay, but I think that the point that the public, I think, would be interested in knowing is, you know, had the budget not been reprofiled, to use that phrase, in the way that it had, that the larger piece of work to replace the truss end links could have taken place.
I think we're conflating, though, Convener, conflating two different things between the specific decision around that and separately how a capital plan then relates to the available resource. But I see Mike desperate to...
I think the other point around the timing of this in 2010, 11 and 11, 12, when the brakes came on in terms of available capital, the Transport Scotland at that time used flexibility to effectively protect FETA's capital spending. So in 2010-11, this is a matter of record from their annual accounts, £1.4 million was advanced into 10-11 to effectively support their programme. And then in 11-12, there was £3.2 million advanced into 11-12. Effectively, that gave them the benefit of increasing the reserves, which were then available for spending in future years.
When we took evidence, we heard that within the capital programme, there was an estimated piece of work to replace the truss end links at an estimated cost of £10 to £15 million. Are you saying that the money was there to do that?
No, that's not what I'm saying.
Maybe tell you what the FETA report says. Can I refer you to that? That in 16th of December 2011, Review of Capital Projects, Table 2, it ranked the priority of the truss end link scheme as 5 out of 13 of reported schemes and not noted as safety critical. Section 3.9 of our own report states that given the cost and difficulty in replacing these elements and the potential disruption to bridge users, further examination of the probability of certain combinations of load occurring, and further structural analysis has been carried out. As a result of this work, there is now the potential to upgrade the existing links rather than carry out a full replacement. Therefore, what that's showing, convener, is that FETA themselves, and this is a matter for FETA to explain, and that's where you've probed quite rightly on this, they began with a view that let's look at the whole truss end links assembly, the whole section. And within that, there were concerns about the truss end, but not where the fault has occurred, not where the unforeseen fault has occurred. They were more concerned about the bracket at the top. I mean, some people say you get the wrong end of the stick. Some people quite genuinely have got the wrong end of the truss. That where the pressure was at the weld at the top of the bracket. That's where there was some concern, not where the unforeseen fault has occurred at the bottom. So there was one early concept to replace the whole, as I understand it, the whole truss end assembly. FETA themselves concluded, for the reasons that I've given, that they could rescope the works. It would be potentially less disruption. By rescoping that and addressing where the problem actually was, that's what they progressed with. That's what stayed in the capital programme. What they didn't proceed with, and we have to get this right, convener, it wasn't a commission to do all these detailed works because there was no design to replace the whole truss end assembly. All they had done was tender for a consultant to come and look at the potential of that piece of work. That's all they tendered for. That's what they didn't proceed with. And what stayed in the capital programme with a lesser priority was that element of truss end link work at the top, not the bottom. And incidentally, that's what Amy inherited following pilot work in May of last year and was proceeding with. Is that accurate? Yeah.
Can I just add
please.
The spending, the indicative capital plan in 2008 identified truss end link work at 500,000 in 2010 and 11. Now, the indicative capital plan in 2011, in February 2011, that moved to 1.5 million in 13-14 and 1.5 million in 14-15. I can't find an indicative capital plan that states £10 to £15 million was in the forward programme. So at the minute, the indicative capital plan in February 11 showed 1.5 million in 13-14 and 1.5 million in 14-15.
We clearly heard in evidence that the replacement of the truss end links would have been in the region of 10 to 15 million. We had an extensive,
That's correct.
Discussion at committee on that.
And I think that brings back to the point that there wasn't a scheme actually sitting there costed. So a range of estimates were probably both put in the capital plan and considered in more generality when you're talking about the truss end links.
Okay, Dave Stewart's anxious to come in on this point.
Thank you, convener. You'll recall, Minister, from the evidence, a question I put to FETA, was that they advertised for consultants, which, as you know, is normal. And in normal events, as your officials, I'm sure, will testify, the engineering consultant would go away, prepare a report, and come back with an action plan for work to be carried out. In my experience, and I could be wrong, it's kind of unusual to advertise for consultants, then pull the advert. The advert went out, and then that was ceased. So we don't know who the consultants would be. We don't know what the consultants would have said. So in one sense, we are kind of looking into our crystal ball to predict what would the consultant have recommended, because a consultant would go away and have done detailed works on the bridge and come back and said to FETA, this is what I want to carry out within that, and this will be the budget range. You've given me an estimate of 10 to 15, as the convener said, but that was pooled. That is factual, isn't it? The advert went out for consultants.
Yes, FETA did decide that. Yes, that's correct.
But the key question is, why was it pooled?
Because the explanation that I've given you is that FETA understood that where there was a view, where there was a concern about the truss end link was at the top of the member, not the bottom, was where the bracket was, where the weld was. That's where there was suspected to be a problem in overstressing. And FETA has looked at that, and again, we're speculating on what FETA has decided. They had a broad range, a cost estimate of between 10 and 15 million pounds for replacing that, but it was just a cost estimate. There was no design. There was no work ready to go. There was no comprehensive capital plan design function ready to go. And they viewed, Again, the language is disruption to bridge users, re-scoping the scheme, cost and affordability, all of those other factors. They could maintain the structure of the bridge and the area of concern by doing a different piece of work, and that's what they proceeded to do. And even that, clearly, by their actions, wasn't top priority in that it stayed in the capital programme, which Amy have inherited, which Amy were undertaking. So that re-scoping of the work was for FETA. Now, if they wanted to proceed, for example, as you've described quite helpfully, Mr. Stewart, if they wanted to proceed with the appointment of those consultants, they could have done. The resources were there to do that. They could have proceeded with that. And, you know, again, we are speculating, but a consultant may have come along and said, why are you proposing to replace the whole truss end assembly when your identified problem is in one part, which, of course, was separate to where the fault, as it turned out, actually occurred? I don't know if that's more helpful.
Back in the end, convener. You recall that I asked that very question to the previous bridge master, and the basic point he came back with was that he had the governments but not the capital programme, and that effectively what was being suggested was that they went to Transport Scotland and that budget wasn't being allowed the green light to go ahead with.
For what?
For the consultants to be employed, who could therefore have gone and looked in more detail at the time.
No, Mr. Stewart, that is not correct. Mm. The decision to proceed or not to proceed on the consultants and the tendering of the consultants for that work was a matter for FETA, and it is not the case that Scottish Government said not to proceed with that at appointment.
At the time, they had governance but not the capital programme. Would you agree with that? There was a different regime at that stage. They weren't masters of their own destiny at that stage.
Well, as I've said, Scottish Government through Transport Scotland had discussion and dialogue with FETA on the resources that would be available. The point I would make again is that, you know, if a piece of work was determined to be critical, it would have been funded, and I've given you an example of how that would have been the case and how generally the capital programme would have been delivered. And I should also add that the capital programme that was devised by FETA and inherited by Scottish Government is being delivered as well. Barry Colford also said that the repair was unforeseen and unforeseeable. I don't think we should lose sight of that. He didn't anticipate this fault occurring, therefore he wasn't proposing to fix something that had been identified, because it hadn't been identified at that point.
I would go back merely to the point that we don't know what the consultants would be coming up with, because the consultants weren't appointed, and what I'm interested in is just the decision making process for it. Did Transport Scotland have any role in saying to FETA, after all they had advertised, why this late change? It was a unanimous decision by FETA board. We have that in it. Well, was it a unanimous decision of FETA board to go ahead and advertise? We were told it was. Sorry. Right, so it was.
The answer I was trying to give was that the value of the consultancy tender was £150,000 to £500,000. FETA could have funded that from their own fund. If they wished to proceed with that consultancy, they could have done it. Transport Scotland were not involved in that consultancy piece of work being withdrawn.
I'm just trying to be clear in my mind that I've got this correct. So am I correct in saying that it was an unanimous decision of FETA to go ahead and advertise for the consultants?
But
clarify that?
No, David's just asking us if a vote at a board at which we weren't,
But you've
having a vote that was unanimous, not
so
you that not a question for FETA.
I'm chairing this meeting of the committee, so if Mr. Stewart wants to ask a question, he's entitled to ask the question, and you can answer it in any way you see.
Well, I'm answering it by saying you're asking us if a vote at a meeting was unanimous. I think you can ask that of FETA.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. In fairness, you've been quite good at quoting FETA minutes back to me. I'm merely asking if you were aware of that. The answer to the question is yes, it was unanimous. We had that on evidence in front of us. So a unanimous decision to go ahead and advertise. We don't know what the consultants would come up with. That consultant report may well have led to further works. We don't know the answer to that question, is the point I made. Are you saying then Transport Scotland had no role over FETA about not to proceed with the work of the consultant?
I think I've said repeatedly that FETA was an independent organisation, and the capital programme, if they wanted to proceed with the appointment of consultants, that would have been a matter for them.
So, finally, convener, was there any role of a Transport Scotland in terms of emails, telephone conversations or memos to suggest to FETA that they should not proceed with this because the capital programme was not going to be available. That's the 10 to 15 million.
Not proceed with the tendering and appointment
yes.
of consultants.
Is there any evidence that you...
Not.
If I could add,
right.
I've reviewed the papers and I find no evidence of either of my former colleagues interfering in what is a matter for FETA. As Roy Brannan has said, FETA could have afforded to go ahead with the consultancy and got the answers to the question I think that we would have all liked to have seen. Also, dependent on the value of the works going out, the Bridgemaster had his own fiscal limits of works he could place with consultants, and he did do so and carry on doing work with Fairhurst and ACOM thereafter. So all I can tell you is, insofar as the evidence I have seen and reviewed, there is no evidence that myself or my former colleagues interfered with FETA's or influenced FETA's decision-making in this matter. This was a matter for them and them alone. And yes, they could have taken forward the consultancy contract, or they could have pursued the work in another manner, which they did with Fairhurst's in a slightly smaller scale. But if I could just finish this by saying it should not be presumed that a more extensive, less cost-effective scheme would have been pursued. A consultant would probably have looked at providing best value for money as part of any optioneering that he did. And when looking at the conceptual design that came out of the workshop, it was a conceptual design. It wasn't a finalised design. And I guess that what's happened since has been evidenced by FETA's downsizing of the scheme. And I think it's oversimplifying the case to consider that a full replacement would have taken place. The last supplementary report, Fairhurst, in 2014, focuses entirely on the tower brackets and welds and not the truss end link post and pin joints, which were noted as not being overstressed. So in the evolution of this process over many reports by Fairhurst, they arrived at a situation providing advice to the FETA board as to the work they needed to do.
I think we'll be interested to compare and contrast what you just said on the record with what Mr. Colford said previously in evidence.
Well, Convener, you also have a deeper understanding. I think sometimes some members just need to look at the detail of what piece of work are we talking about, what piece of contractual obligation. You know, revenue and capital budget's important as well, because I've described how the overall settlement was reached, and I've described how FETA, where there's an expectation, would have a tiered approach to their capital programme. Take an example of this. I would imagine that appointment of consultants would probably have come from revenue, potentially, rather than capital. And you know, that's a matter that FETA would be able to explain.
Okay.
The records at the time, anyway.
Can I just add
sure.
one further point? Having checked through the records, FETA's records, I can only find the first time that Barry reports to the board that there's a reduced scheme in December 2011. I can't find a record of Barry reporting to the board that the tender for the consultancy has been withdrawn. Now, that might well be there. We might not have a complete set of records, but that's our finding. At the minute, December 11, that's the first time that a refocused scheme has been brought to the board.
The committee has attempted to obtain from both Transport Scotland and former FETA officials any documentation which might show the process of dialogue and discussion between the two bodies with regard to FETA's indicative capital plan and the allocation of funding by the Scottish Government following the 2011 spending review. Minister, can you say whether such documentation exists, and if so, is it the intention to provide the committee with further information?
Yes, I believe we can provide you with more information, and I'll do that this afternoon, Convener.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to move on. I'm going to ask Alex Johnson to...
Thank you very much, Convener. Just looking at the way things are now, could you tell us who is now responsible for preparing the capital plan setting out necessary future work on the bridge?
Again, that would be a matter between the operating company that we have and Transport Scotland. So identifying works that are required, available resources, you know, what's a priority, again, what will ensure the the ongoing operation of the bridge to our satisfaction, not undermine the structural integrity of the bridge, and have that ongoing dialogue. As Mike is largely responsible for this, I'll ask Mike to explain a bit more of the mechanism.
Yes, certainly. With the abolition of FETA in 2015-16, we effectively inherited a capital plan. And the draft budget that's in front of Parliament at the moment for 16-17 actually reflects the content of that plan. There's 9.1 million in terms of capital.
FETA's capital plan when yes. You inherited it.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Now, so within your, well, first of all, have you made any changes to that? You've been in that position for, over half a year now. Have there been any changes to the plan?
The overall quantum of the plan hasn't changed, but with any capital plan, there's a constant reassessment of priority within that for the maintenance of any asset. There'll be, leaving aside the issues that have been, the subject of spend since December. That's a constant review process that Amy would go through in conjunction with colleagues in Transport Scotland. The interface with the budget process is about making sure that ongoing review of what makes up that plan, understanding the priorities, is then fed through into the spending review process. And that's an ongoing process that we take across business within Transport Scotland, not just in this matter.
I'm interested in this process of how you prioritise within the process.
I wonder if I could assist and help on that one. Just to go back, the 15-16 FETA capital programme was reviewed and adopted during the six-month mobilisation. It was a contract obligation of AMI, our new provider, and FETA were part of the mobilisation process. So during that period, it was reviewed in detail. And there were some slight changes and additions to it. You must understand that the new Fourth Bridges unit now includes a short length of trunk road motorway that previously was part of another unit. So as part of our plan, we've got some pavement works, safety barrier upgrades, and all the things that go with maintaining a section of motorway in there. But the bulk of the structural work to the Fourth Road Bridge remains as programmed and prioritised by FETA. With regard to how that programme comes about, FETA themselves on the bridge inspect and maintain and, well, they inspect and rank the defects in accordance with the Fourth Road Bridge Engineering Manual, which, as I say, it's been developed over a number of years to reflect best practice. Originally written by the designers, it's been changed over the years. And within there is a ranking system. Now, that ranking system is not dissimilar to what we use in national standards across the rest of the trunk road network. And that sets out to rank defects in a rating, with safety critical ones being ranked 4 or 5, and then going down to 3, 2, and 1 on the FETA system, and 3, 2, and 1 on the design manual for roads and bridges national standards. The systems align quite closely, and within that will advise you from your different work streams that you're taking forward, because not everything will fall within to a structural ranking. You may be doing some work to a building as well that you have to consider, and these then sit within a programme. Now, overarching that, what we have introduced as part of our system is something that we do for the rest of the trunk road network, and that includes Keswick Bridge that Mr. Stewart has an interest in, and Erskine Bridge, and that is a tool we've developed which is a value management tool that flows out of work done by the London LOBEG, which is the London Bridge Engineering Group, which was adopted and developed by the Highways Agency, and then we took it on some years ago and revised it for Scotland. Now, I won't call it a sausage machine where you pour everything into the top, turn the handle, and it comes out, but that, rather like a risk management tool, allows us today to take on economic, other sensitivities that might influence where things sit in our programmes that aren't simply related to structural safety or structural integrity. And as part of that process, we come up with our own indicative capital programmes. And under the Fourth Bridges unit contract, the function of doing that will fall to Amy, but it will be closely scrutinised and looked at by my staff.
So at that critical point, is it the case that the level of capital grant for repairs is determined by the needs of the capital plan, or are the works determined by the level of funding available?
It's a two-way process. It's fair to say it's a two-way process, but you have certain principles that what you're committing to financially doesn't ever undermine the structural integrity of the bridge. And, you know, it could be said that in 16, 17, the government's hardly flush with cash, but there's actually an increase for the Fourth Road Bridge. So the budget announced for 16, 17, of course we'll be voting on, is £5.1 million revenue and £9 million capital maintenance budget, which is an increase from £4 million last year. So there's an example of it. It doesn't necessarily reflect, you know, normal trends and available resource, but what is necessary, and that's as Wayne has described. So there's an example of budget impact. In terms of the question as well around capital spend on the bridge, of course there's been more capital spend on the bridge than was anticipated as a result of the closure. So you could argue that the £1.5 million for the structural monitoring equipment is, you know, spend on the bridge in addition to the already approved capital programme. And in no sense of the works that we've undertaken as a consequence of the closure going to impact on the capital plan. It's not compromised. This is additional resource. Mike?
Can I just add a couple of points to that? The way the budget is calculated for the Fourth Bridge is no different than any other part of Transport Scotland. So we have a long-term financial plan that's developed from a bottom-up approach. So the needs are identified and aggregated up in terms of an overall financial plan. There's then a discussion around relative priorities, as has been described, and what needs to go ahead within the available resource that's available. But that process is built up from a base. It's not simply saying, here's an amount of money, what can you do with it? And because of the nature of asset management and capital planning generally, we don't tend to have flat lines or straight lines in terms of spend on assets. It will depend on what the maintenance regime or programme tends to be, and it can fluctuate quite a bit. So that's all part of the financial planning process that we apply within Transport Scotland generally.
Would it also be the case that the list of priorities and the funding available, that if something was near the top of that list of priorities, it would have an impact on capital funding decisions, whereas something that was lower on the list would be less likely to have an impact on capital funding decisions?
Fair.
So individual projects or potential projects would have different, as their priority was determined, their priority within budgeting would be the same as well. So all things are not treated equally, that's what I'm...
No, I think what I've tried to describe, and Wayne maybe add to it, as part of an asset management approach, you wouldn't look at everything in the same light. You would look at a ranking and a risk-based approach to what you need to spend your money on. And that would be a matter of course, regardless of whether you had 5, 10, 15, 20 million, you would still look at it in that priority, just in terms of delivering value for money and spending on the right things.
If I may add to what Mike said, the prioritised indicative capital programmes that we come with for all our operating companies and for the Fourth Bridges unit, they determine utopian budget requirements, in a sense, because they will often be looking many years ahead. But as Richard Fish, one of your independent experts, says when he was managing the Tamar, he lived in the real world as well as living in the engineer's world, and I do as well. And I have very close working relationships with Mike and my asset management colleague to identify the high priority schemes that require to be taken forward. And this informs the level of budget to be allocated against a broad basket of other sort of, should we say, cross-disciplinary functions within Transport Scotland. So to go back to your original question and answer it, which I think the Minister already, it's a two-way process, and we do our best to satisfy the works priorities and within the budget availability, and also seeking additional budget when it becomes available by having schemes that we can deliver rapidly. And I think you understand Transport Scotland does have a good record of having shovel-ready schemes and delivering them and having them ready, and that is part of our remit. So within inside that indicative capital programme, below the red line on the page that indicates that's above which that's the budget you've got, you always need to keep a cadre of schemes ready to deliver should, for some reason, additional budget become available, and we can deliver those priorities ahead of schedule.
Mm-hmm. The economic impact of this closure has been quite considerable. In the era prior to December last year, did the Scottish Government take into account, when it assessed these priorities, any broader economic impact that may be as a result of significant closures such as this one?
Can I maybe clarify the question, Mr. Johnson? Do you mean in relation to closure or before closure?
I mean in more general terms, but the closure last year is an extremely good example and one that we can use as an example, that the broad economic impact was very significant. Was that kind of cost taken into account by the government in prioritising work on the bridge prior to the closure last year?
Of course it is. That's why we're building a £1.3 billion replacement crossing immediately beside the Forth Road Bridge whilst continuing to invest in the Forth Road Bridge. Now, that's an example of how you consider economic impact in your capital spend. So we're maintaining what we've got and we're building the replacement crossing because of its criticality to the transport network and the impact in the area. So of course economic consideration plays a part in that, when your objective is to ensure the structural integrity of the bridge. We're not just doing that, so we've got a structure that's there, so it's fit for purpose, and its purpose is to allow transport over it. So of course that's part of the mix, and the political considerations of what our priorities, and the Queensferry crossing is one such capital priority. And then to add to that, the second part of your question was around the closure itself. So in recognition of the impact that closure, necessary closure because of safety being paramount, would have on the community, that's why we enacted the very comprehensive travel action plan and ensured that there was more bus and train provision and more information out there, working with our partners, as well as that key priority to get the bridge reopened as quickly as possible. We could have spent less money, we could have taken more time, we might not have commissioned people to put in the effort that they did to get the bridge reopened as quickly as possible, but exactly because of the impact on the area, on people's lives, on businesses and local communities, we made it the number one priority to reopen the bridge as quickly as possible and safely, with confidence, and committed the resources that you've heard about to do that. So yes, economic impact features in capital spend decisions and how we respond.
Can I just add to that? I think for a bit generality around how Transport Scotland look after its asset, on structural road maintenance schemes, there is an asset management hierarchy across all of the trunk road network, which takes into account socio-economic impacts, safety, functionality, and that's used in the value management process of prioritising road structural maintenance schemes on a yearly basis.
Experience in December last year and the period since has been, it's had a substantial impact and it's been a difficulty for the government to have to deal with that. Has it taught you anything? Has it changed the way that you will react to similar incidents in future?
I think it's fair to say that this was unforeseen. There are various incident plans and contingency plans in place in the event of disruption. But the nature of this fall, and therefore the necessary closure, was unforeseen. And all of the contingency plans were scaled up to meet the circumstance that we faced. That was diversion routes, that was traffic management, that was bridge control, policing, how we engage with local authorities. So I think there are always lessons that can be learned and how we deal with partners and the public. And I think we moved very quickly. Before being praised for getting the bridge open so quickly, Transport Scotland was quite rightly, and all our stakeholders and partners were praised for the travel action plan that was put in place. And that was within hours of the decision to close the bridge, the preparations for that for people going back to work on the Monday. And that involved extra rail rolling stock and buses and a great deal of coordination. So a further lesson learned is I think, for everyone to keep working in partnership in the event of a major issue such as this, because it was critical to the country's transport system. Do you know, there's smaller lessons learned, like how to engineer works. I gave the example of how we were able to accelerate the works on the repair. So our operating companies have learned something around doing more work in the workshops rather than on site because it's of the weather factor. So I think there's a number of different lessons learned in operating and responding to incidents. And from a political perspective, I think it's been the right thing to do to be transparent. And what I mean by that is the statement to Parliament, the technical briefings that were offered to members, many chose to involve themselves in those technical briefings. And therefore, I think that degree of transparency has been very healthy as well. But the response that was sought was to focus on getting the bridge reopened fully as quickly as possible, and that's where our energies were centred on.
And if I could just again add to that I've been involved in transport, leading transport resilience since the Glasgow airport attack, and we've dealt with many incidents across the network, whether it's pandemic flu, flooding, volcanic ash, landslides. You learn on every occasion, and we will do the same here. Wayne's already got in motion a series of debriefs with a whole range of individuals and stakeholders to make sure that we improve our resilience going forward.
Thank you.
Thank you. We've already touched on the estimated total cost of the phases 1 to phase 3 repairs to the bridge following the recent closure, and these are clearly not insignificant at £19.7 million. The enforced closure also caused significant and ongoing travel and economic disruption, which we've talked about. Minister, would you wish to comment on whether, with the benefit of hindsight, it might have been preferable for FETA? Now, I accept it was FETA's decision, not your decision, but it would have been preferable for FETA to have taken forward its truss end link replacement proposals as set out in that 2010 capital plan in a planned and managed way, thus avoiding these high repair costs and the unplanned disruption, which you rightly said could not have been foreseen.
I think it's fair to say, Convener, we just don't know, because we've been asked to speculate on a decision of another organisation and the factors that were in play at the time. And fundamentally, this fault was unforeseen and it was unforeseeable. And I think there's a great deal of consensus around that. So it's hard to say the what-ifs, what if FETA had proceeded with consultants, what would that consultant have recommended, what would the available resources have been at the time, when would that have worked, could have been profiled, would the pins have seized up before then. There are so many unknowns, it would be unfair of me to make a judgment on whether FETA got it right or wrong with all of those unknowns. And I say again, this was an unforeseeable fault. The pressure point that did exist, that was identified, it was being pursued and repaired. And ironically, that isn't what caused the current fault or the current closure. And I think we all have to bear that in mind. And when I say current fault and current closure, it's the current closure we were discussing. There is now no closure of the Fourth Road Bridge. Of course, it's a historic closure now.
Thank you. I mean, we have heard in evidence that the nature of the fault was, as you say, unforeseen and unforeseeable. And I think the committee understands that, but I think what the public want to know is, could this have been avoided if that decision had been taken by FETA to replace the truss end links as part of that, part of the 2010 capital plan? Was it something that could have been avoided? Is the question that the public will have.
But we genuinely don't know, because we don't know what, and you know, FETA wouldn't have known. That's what I'm describing, what their commission would have led to in the end, what timescale that would have taken and what it would have concluded. And I think Wayne's very helpfully said that a consultant, you know, worth their salary might have come back and said, what is the problem, what are you trying to fix and how do you get there, and might have concluded that you don't need to replace the full truss end assembly, the whole section. You can identify the points, and it would be more cost effective to identify the points that are being overstressed and fix that. And ultimately that's what FETA embarked upon based on the information that they had at the time. So we don't know whether FETA would have been able to proceed or not. But do you know, for the purpose of clarity, since there was a lot of political noise about this, I was asked on a radio interview if full replacement of the whole assembly went ahead, would that have captured the bit that was broken? By chance, it might have done. But it's all ifs, and we don't know, because if FETA had proceeded to decided to replace the whole assembly, by accident, by chance, the bit that became the fault may have been replaced, but it would have been by chance. It wasn't because it was identified, and that wasn't a programme that they embarked upon anyway. So what they did was, again, to be fair, proportionate, and in view of the advice and the assessments that they had at the time, but they re-scoped their work in light of what I've described. Does that help, Convener?
It all helps. Do members have any...
I think Scott said in the earlier evidence that I think he'd gone around the table and asked all the witnesses at that point whether or not that was the right decision. It was the right decision by Barry and the team at that time to take forward the reduced scheme and to look at the area that was actually impacted, because they just didn't know about any other fault on the Truss End Link Assembly.
May I add to what Royce Brannan's just said there? There seems to be an implication that FETA did nothing, that they withdrew. They didn't. They carried on I think we just need to be... I'd like to make it clear to the committee convener then. FETA carried on a close working relationship with a consultant and looked at a number of different options. And there is, if those reports are read sequentially, there is a good technical trail in there showing where they were leading to and where they arrived at in 2014.
Passed to the committee? Do you know? Okay, thank you.
They were part of the original...
In terms of the board
they
papers.
Were part of the original evidence pack submitted before we came.
I just wanted to be clear, because clearly there is further information that is going to be
forthcoming. No, you have these.
Okay, thank you.
And the point I'm making is, and I'm not expecting everyone to sit down and read them as bedtime reading, but there is a logical thought trail that runs through them that says, here's where we got to at a workshop, and here's where we got to in 2014. And we were asked by yourself, and I thought that was a proportionate, and as a former consulting engineer of over 21 years in the private sector, and I did work for the original designers of this bridge, I thought it was a proportionate way to take it forward.
The premise of your question was also, if FETA had taken a certain decision to do a certain thing and see that through, would there have been cost and disruption? Well, yes, there would. Of course there would. To execute the works, there would have also been disruption, and there would also have been cost, which hadn't been fully quantified to follow.
The question was that would have been then done in a planned and managed way.
But there
which
would
by its very nature could have minimised the disruption so that the work was done at weekends and
it would be hard, so I would imagine, and I'm not the engineer, but to replace the full assembly would come with some disruption and some significant cost. But because the works were never actually fully designed, never fully costed, never put out to tender for that full assembly replacement, the honest answer is I don't know, but we are being as helpful as we possibly can, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Once the Queensferry crossing has opened later this year, the traffic on the Fourth Road Bridge will reduce significantly. What works will then be carried out which have been delayed so as not to disrupt the traffic across the bridge?
Convener, what works do you seem to have the impression have been delayed?
Well, clearly the priority has been to reopen the bridge. So now that has...
I'm not sure how that relates to the Queensferry crossing, because there's been no impact on the works on the Fourth Road Bridge on the Queensferry crossing that I'm aware of. So the Queensferry crossing works are progressing as they were, and the Fourth Road Bridge, as well as repairing it, we've also taken the opportunity to accelerate other works rather than delay them. So I'm not sure why there's any perception of delay.
Okay. Fine. We'll move on in that case. Adam, you have some questions.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Could I ask some questions about the arrangements for inspection at the bridge? How is the contract to inspect the Fourth Road Bridge managed and paid for? For example, is it a lump sum payment for to carry out a predefined series of inspections? We're not quite clear on the inspection regime as is now.
I'll say one thing about the inspection regime, and then I'll ask Wayne to give you more detail. The current inspection regime is very much what was inherited from FETA, and that's informed by the very construction of the Fourth Road Bridge and learning over a number of years, and international learning as well. So the level of inspections, that which was inherited, and it's a live document, the bridge manual itself. So it's it's the history of the bridge, it's the ongoing nature of it, and the inspections were inherited, and we know how the, I'm sure it's been explained how the fault was identified on inspection and the regime that was inherited. But I think it's fair to say now, with even more understanding of the bridge and the new monitoring equipment as well, that will add to the inspection regime. So it's even more robust with that new technology that we have on the bridge, with that deeper understanding. And so that's some confidence around the inspection regime, that this fault had only occurred within weeks, was identified, and then we moved into the remedial work and repairs, and there is the more forensic inspection. I would also want to add, convener, because I think this is important for the committee to learn, we have taken the opportunity during the bridge closure to do a painstaking, a thorough investigation of the bridge, and there are no new substantial defects, no substantial faults. You know, there are some issues, smaller issues, that get picked up and addressed as a matter of course. But we took the opportunity of the full bridge closure to carry out that more comprehensive inspection in any event, in addition to the already programmed inspections. And Wayne can say a bit more about the payment regime between operating company and government.
If I can add to what the Minister said, committee. The bridge inspections, just to put it into context, have continued under AMI, using the same staff and the same procedures that were developed, tried and tested and used by FETA. All the bridge inspections, well, we know about the two-pay arrangements. Everyone went over. I understand one of the inspectors has retired just due to the natural course of things. But apart from that, it is the same staff. Now, the fourth road bridge inspections are undertaken in accordance with the fourth road bridge engineering manual, which I touched upon earlier. This has been updated and developed over the years and to reflect best practice, and I think that's been said before, so I'll not say it again. And it's a live document, and the process is kept under constant review to ensure it aligns with best practice. Now, to put you in the picture, during the development of the fourth bridges unit contract, the people that developed the contract for us are a company who are now called CH2M. They were called CH2M Hill or Halcrow, you may have heard of. And they engaged one of the country's foremost bridge specialists, Flint and Neil. And it was a Neil McFadden, who's one of their senior staff, to do a review of the Fourth Road Bridge Engineering Manual to give us the confidence as Scottish Government and Transport Scotland represented Scottish Government that what was in that manual reflected best practice. And there are a number of high-level consultants you've heard of, but Flint and Neil, for whom one of your independent experts, John Evans, was a former senior partner, are recognised as a world leader in this event and have experience on a number of these types of bridges around the world, mainly Severn, but also Westgate in Melbourne. Anyway, to put it simply, there were very few changes made, but it brought to my staff's attention what needed to be done. Now, I won't talk any more about the generalities of the inspection manuals, but the very simple answer is, in line with our other operating companies, the inspections, those predefined inspections that are well specified, well defined and well laid down for the Forth Bridges operating companies, are paid for as a series of monthly lump sums. Any additional inspections that arise out of that, or special inspections that arise out of that, are paid for separately, usually at a term we call professional service rates, or if we need to bring in an outside expert, at the costs associated with bringing in that outside expert. So it's not the case that if we find something during inspections, we expect AMI to absorb those costs within that lump sum. If we need to go out and do weld testing, or if we need to bring a company in like Strainstall, as we did, to assist, or whomever, that is paid for in addition. And part of our budget is set aside to do that. And we tend always to have an ongoing series of, I'll call them special investigations, that arise out of the principal and general inspection programme, that tackling issues that occur there. I hope that is helpful.
Yeah, I mean, you mentioned that best practice is constantly evolving, and presumably standards reflect that. I think somebody mentioned earlier on that all over the world, people will be looking at pins in their suspension bridges now. But how is this actually, all these developments as they happen, how are they incorporated in the inspection regime going forward?
Well, whilst it's a live document, there are opportunities to introduce changes through the contract, through contract change mechanism. And if anything substantial were to come forward that we felt needed introducing today, tomorrow, that would be done. But as I've explained, as part of the development of the contract, a full review has taken place. And within a couple of years' time, as part of the development of the next phase of the contract, the same process will be gone through. It is formally and contractually, but that's not strictly true. FETA, as a roads authority at the time, was responsible for setting its own inspection standards. Now, clearly, it reflected the best practice developed over the years by the Department for Transport and its long-span structures around Britain. And it sat on a number of what you might call national, international, and UK forums. Now, Transport Scotland, myself and my immediate colleagues below me, I and they sit on a number of UK forums to review, share, disseminate and collaborate on developments of best practice, the key ones of which, and FETA sat on these groups, and I know Barry Crawford very well from this. The UK Roads Liaison Group was sat upon by Roy Brannan for a number of years and now Donald Morrison. I sit on the Bridge Owners Forum, the UK Bridges Board, the Scots Bridges Group. I'm a member of IABSE, which is the International Association of Bridge and Structural Engineering. And part of my task is to review, absorb, and determine and discuss with Roy and the other senior managers if things that are arising in the industry that we need to take cognizance of to build into our contracts. We also now sit on the Longspan Bridges Group, of which is a UK forum of which Barry was a member, and that's Severn, Humber, Tamar, Dartford. You must understand as well that Transport Scotland, as a Scottish Trunk Roads Authority, is the overseeing organisation for all structural standards and design approvals on all trunk roads in the whole of Scotland. So given that that's a key part of our work, a key part of my section's work is to keep up to date on what's going on these UK organisations, and it can be a bit of a Sisyphus task at times, pushing the stone uphill all the time, but it is a key part of what we do, and individual engineers within my section have individual portfolios for which they are the point of contact and are responsible for, whether it's Bridge Strike Prevention Group, Concrete Bridge Development, which Dr. Hazel McDonald sits on, the recent ongoing work on BIM, Building Information Modelling, which is a Department for Transport initiative to take us all forward. And you've seen the flowering results of that through Amy, of some of their beautiful schematics and computer-generated graphics. Another key piece of work we're working on is deterioration modelling. Another one after some tunnel collapses is safety critical fixings. And the key one that's been implemented this year is the new Bridge Inspector Competency course to train future bridge inspections. So we have a role at the heart of these organisations, and it doesn't necessarily make us experts, it just means we're better informed than most.
Okay.
Can I maybe add to that with your indulgence, convener, just to say that as well as that, all the expertise and understanding about the bridge was seamlessly transferred over from FETA to Amy, and also within that expertise within Government and Transport Scotland, I think we did rely upon Amy as well and their international connections to be able to execute the repairs in the way that we've been able to do as well, because it's clearly a big organisation and part of a bigger organisation. So that resilience, that shared understanding, I think, has also helped, to be fair. And we had some of the best people in the world, as far as I'm concerned, informing our thinking on the repair and the modelling. And also rest assured that the understanding is documented, so it isn't just with individuals, that it's there on record to understand the behaviour, as it's described, of the bridge. And, of course, there are comparisons are made around the world. And, interestingly, we're not aware of any similar fault with a mechanism that, you know, that could have alerted us to this happening on the Forth Road Bridge.
I'd just like to add to what the Minister said. It's a matter of interest that Barry Crawford, in his latest venture, is working on a structure called the Walt Whitman Bridge in North America, which has a truss end link system on it, and I'm not aware they've got problems with that. They're not common, these truss end link systems, because they vary on the bridge type, but they are not unknown.
Hopefully that was comprehensive.
But enough for you, convener.
Well, I'm not sure we've finished yet.
On that question.
Do you have any further questions?
Well, I'm reassured that Transport Scotland are on the ball, okay. But we've heard throughout this whole inquiry about structural health monitoring various bits of kit that can be used nowadays to monitor the performance of elements of the bridge ongoing. And I think I was correct in hearing you saying we've spent $1 million to $1.5 million on monitoring the pins now, the 8 pin joints. Is that correct? Yeah. Is there anything more that you can, any other information you can provide on this? Do you intend to install any more equipment on the bridge going forward, or is that sufficient?
I think where we are at the moment is having more technology on the bridge than ever before, and some of it's the latest technology, of course, designed for what was identified as the issues on the Fourth Road bridge. And in terms of what has been installed, it does include sensors, strain gauges, tilt meters, temperature gauges, fibre optic lines, electrical feeds, data acquisition units to ensure that we have the best information. What is it testing? The stress limits on the bridge. That's what informed the decisions as to what traffic we could allow over, working with the modelling. So there's the modelling of what's happening in the bridge, then there's the actual live load testing where we were able to run gritters over the bridge, so you can do modelling, then you can do the live testing, and through the monitoring equipment that we have, Mr. Ingram, we can see the impact it's having on the behaviour of the bridge as well as the other indicators. You know, humans are actually quite important too, so you know, the inspections are important, because some of this is not just about the high technology, but actual visual inspection, even noise, and you know, just what can be seen. So we'll continue to use the range of different methods to inspect the bridge, but with even more technology on it, we've got a deeper understanding of the behaviour of the bridge, and I think that new equipment has been helpful, and it's what's given us the confidence to assess what can be allowed over the bridge, which right now is fully operational, and we can know in good time what the stresses are on the individual members. And you know, when looking at what was the fault, you know, what was the crack, you know, metallurgists have suggested it was fatigue, essentially, and the stress on the member can now be assessed by this equipment, and that's more information than we would have had before in light of what has happened. So before it was unforeseeable, but knowing the history, knowing what has happened, we've got more technology and we've put in precautionary repairs and we've strengthened the bridge in a way that you would expect us to. So there are no further plans for any additional equipment, but each piece of equipment has been appropriate to the issue and the circumstances. I recall a statement to Parliament, or an answer to a question actually, around the dehumidification system and the acoustic monitoring, which was because of the concern around the cables at the time. So I think it just shows that we're responding to each issue. Of course, we'll try and predict, but I am not Mystic Meg. I do not have a crystal ball. I do not know what the unforeseen is, but we'll certainly do what we can to predict and to prepare and to have the contingencies in place. But I think that's substantial investment. What I would also like to add in terms of lessons learned from Mr. Ingram in terms of new technology, Mr. Johnston, in terms of wider lessons learned, I think it's now reasonable to say, well, what level of equipment would we have on the Queen's Ferry crossing to understand the behaviour of that bridge as well? And so I think that's very helpful for us now to have that expertise that's been established, and we'll commit to that in the Queen's Ferry crossing.
Okay.
Just to add to the Minister's point here, the Queen's Ferry crossing will be the first bridge in the UK with a SHM built in from scratch, so heavily instrumented, new control room built into the federal offices to allow that to be monitored remotely.
I apologise if you would like me not to say this, but you did ask the question about what we're doing in the future, mm-hmm. and the Minister answered very good. However, I have asked for a feasibility study here to look and review and to assess and give us advice on future locations and next locations on the bridge where, funding permitting and dependent on what the structural health monitoring will tell us, where we can install strain gauges, tilt meters, measurements. And some of these remote monitoring locations may perhaps be the expansion joints and the viaduct movement joints, so that we can get an accurate record of just exactly what they're doing during the day and the night. But the point I think also needs making, we also have quite a lot of structural health monitoring on the bridge. It has been said by others that we've got acoustic monitoring of the cables, dehumidification, geospatial sensors on the bridge, monitored remotely from Nottingham University, that are telling us that it's moving 4.5 metres up and down and 7.5 metres laterally, which came as a surprise to some of us. But it is, and the plots are very interesting. But there was a point, a very valuable point made by Barry Crawford. And whilst he didn't say that visual inspection remains our primary method of inspecting things and the ability to put your fingernail into a crack and get up close and personal, we have to be careful with structural health monitoring that it's a very new thing, that we don't end up with data overload whereby we have a great deal of information coming at us and no idea what to do with it. So we will be in learning mode for quite a while.
Okay. Right, that was a fairly comprehensive answer to my question, yes. But the Minister's no Donald Rumsfeld then, with his known unknowns and unknown unknowns and all the rest of it. So yeah. I'm no doubt he's relieved at that. I'll pass now.
Thank you. Michael.
Oh, me. Thank you. Most people don't refer to me as questions Michael, but as Mike, as per the name tag. Just before we leave this fascinating discussion about structural health monitoring, can I ask Minister if there was any consideration given for this, you know, structural health monitoring for the truss end link or any other part of the bridge before the failure in December of the truss end link?
I'm not aware of any discussion to that effect, because the concerns were around, you know, other parts of the bridge, like the cables, as I've discussed, and there we had the acoustic monitoring, or where there was an identified problem was at the bracket, and there was an identified programme of works to take that forward. So I'm not aware of any previous discussion on installing these mechanisms. And bear in mind that some of this technology has been made to measure for the Forth Road Bridge in light of incidents, and that's appropriate.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. And I think we've covered that pretty exhaustively on that subject. Mr. Colford explained to the committee that when he was the bridge master, he was a member of the International Cable Supported Bridge Operators Association. And therefore he was able to learn from good practice across the world. I wonder if there's any continuing arrangement whereby that good practice from across the world can be tapped into.
Well, yes, we're still involved in, as Wayne quite exhaustively described, the local, regional, national and international forums in terms of intelligence on bridge structures. So there's still that deep understanding, yes.
Thank you. And
incidentally, just you know, for completeness, you know, bridge masters still do talk to each other and share that expertise. So that's very helpful too.
Yep. Thank you. And we'd heard in the course of the inquiry that the Humber Bridge has a maintenance regime that's based on a 60-year plan. Given that there's a, you know, there will be a reduction in the traffic utilising this bridge when the new bridge opens, and what's the expected continuing lifespan of this bridge?
Ongoing strong maintenance of the bridge can see the bridge continue as long as we want. Essentially, if you keep reinvesting in it, if you keep maintaining it and replacing it as required, the bridge can continue for the time scale that we want, as long as you keep maintaining it and investing in it. Previous lifespans have been issued between, you know, 50 and 70 years, but these are all estimates. If you keep investing in it, renewing it, maintaining it, it can last as long as we want, is the advice that I've been given.
Thank you. And just moving on to a slightly different subject, we've heard a lot in the course of the inquiry about the disruptive effect of the bridge closure and so on. And but I just wonder, have there been any, has there been any upside to that at all in terms of commuter behaviour or whatever?
We obviously want modal shift from the car into public transport. I, as Transport Minister, would particularly want to encourage that. And our travel plan saw, during the period of closure, a clear shift into public transport, which is welcomed. More so rail than in bus, actually, even though there was a bus priority lane as well as the goods priority lane as well. But there's certainly far more use of public transport. That's welcomed. There was extra rolling stock provided to the area and enhanced staffing at public transport points. One of the advantages, just as a walk forward, was an earlier train put on in the morning. And actually we've maintained, or ScotRail has maintained that service because it's turned out to have, you know, ongoing demand. So there's a public transport benefit which is welcomed, and it encouraged a lot of people to use public transport who maybe weren't using it before. And if we want to achieve modal shift, people do need to get out of their cars and into public transport. I do appreciate the forbearance and the patience of the public and businesses in the local area during the period of disruption. But yes, there were public transport benefits, such as now an improved rail timetable, and more people were used to using public transport. We are actually undertaking an evaluation exercise. It won't be in time for the committee, I don't think. It's not central to your inquiry in any event, but an understanding of how people responded themselves to disruption, and I'm happy to share that if the committee is interested. And it does look at how people respond to disruption, and for example, how they got to work and use of public transport. But it showed a significant shift during the period, and there are ongoing benefits.
That sounds interesting. And my final question now, convener. When we heard from the panel of independent experts, they were lavish in their praise for the whole bridge team and everybody involved with this process in terms of getting the problem identified and then remedial action undertaken very quickly indeed. But I think you yourself, Minister, have had a very hands-on involvement in the whole process, and you touched on the initial decision, but could you perhaps describe for the committee what your involvement has been as this story has unfolded and come to the happy conclusion that it has?
I think it's fair to say that transport ministers have a very particular experience during winter. This was unforeseen, but quite intense. I think when we looked at the record, over 20 ministerial calls or engagements, of course, sometimes including cabinet secretaries, first minister, deputy first minister with lead responsibility and resilience, a number of site visits and very frequent reports to make sure that we were on top of this issue. I was left under no illusion that the priority was to ensure public safety, but to get the bridge reopened as quickly as possible, and that's where all the energies have been. We've also taken advantage, in a sense, of the closure. We've actually accelerated. That's why I was somewhat thrown by a question of delay. We've actually supported works to the Queensferry crossing that will now have taken place with less disruption because they've taken place during the Fourth Road Bridge closure, and works associated with the Fourth Road Bridge themselves, such as the carriageways and other works that might have required future disruption. Actually, we tried to do as much as we could during the closure whilst fixing the bridge because the bridge was closed. And I remember repeated calls, can we not let pedestrians and cyclists across the Fourth Road Bridge during closure? And as much as we would have liked to have done that, we couldn't compromise public safety because it was a live work site, and there are the issues that you understand around the fault on the bridge. So the positives are there are always lessons to be learned. We upscaled the contingency plans. There was strengthened public transport. There's now more monitoring equipment on the Fourth Road Bridge with better understanding, and even better understanding of its behaviour. And I think somewhat a degree of vindication that building the new Queensferry crossing was the right thing to do. It's a substantial contingency for the Fourth Road Bridge and vice versa. And, you know, there are choices for the future on the role of the Fourth Road Bridge. It was in the Act what its use would be. and it could be for a future government to consider looking at what its role should be. Queensferry Crossing was to be a replacement bridge, but you know, there might be options for the future of the Forth Road Bridge as well, well maintained. I'm happy to write to the committee convener with the extra works that we were able to undertake and to give that sense of what we were able to do during the period of closure that makes my point going into the detail around carriageway improvement, landscaping works, structural.
I think that's what I was alluding to earlier.
More than happy, yeah.
Resurfacing was one of the
absolutely.
Issues.
And rather it be a delay, it in no sense caused delay. It was actually acceleration and much better timing of the works, which then has reduced the need for further disruption or closure or anything else. And we thought it was fit and appropriate to do that whilst repairing the bridge, where clearly was our number one priority. But I thank Mike McKenzie for his praise, but actually the people who deserve the praise, of course, are the staff who worked in all weathers to repair the bridge, and they knew this was a priority for Scotland, not just the Scottish Government, and again, I would like to thank them all.
Do members have any... I'm aware that we've had a very comprehensive session, but do members have any final closing questions? No. Is there anything further you'd like to say in conclusion, Minister?
I think I've covered my answers as fully as I possibly can, but there will be that information that you requested coming this afternoon by way of engagement. And if you require anything else, please raise it with me, because I think it is important in this issue. As I said throughout the bridge closure, that when engineers and experts were exposed to Parliament, I think everyone would be filled with confidence that the government and our agencies' interventions have been right, proportionate, appropriate, putting public safety first and working to repair the bridge as quickly as possible. And I think we're left in a much stronger position as a result.
Thank you. Well, on behalf of the committee, can I thank you for your commitment and also for your very comprehensive evidence this morning and willingness to engage in a constructive and positive way with the committee. And can I particularly thank Transport Scotland officials for their experience and expertise in making that available to the committee, not just today, but throughout this inquiry. So on that note of thanks, can I suspend briefly to allow the witnesses to leave the room? Thank you. of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. The fourth item for today is the consideration of two negative instruments, the Public Contracts Scotland Amendment Regulations 2016 and the Water and Sewerage Services Licences Cross-Border Application Scotland Order 2016. Papers 5 and 6 summarise the purpose and prior consideration of these instruments. The committee will now consider any issues that it wishes to raise in reporting to the Parliament on these instruments. Members should note that no motions to annul have been received in relation to the instruments, and I invite comments from members. There are no comments from members. Has the committee agreed that it does not wish to make any recommendation in relation to these instruments? We are agreed. That is agreed. I now move this meeting into private session.